How's it going, folks? Welcome to another fun at-home table read. Tonight, we are jumping into easily a script I never thought I was going to be able to find. We have the script for the unmade Guillermo del Toro-directed Justice League Dark. This is his take on the magical side of the DC universe. I can't wait to jump into the script, so we're just going to get right in with introducing ourselves.
I'm Eric. I will be the action description.
I'm Logan. I'm going to be reading Constantine. We have Curtis. He's going to be joining us soon, and he's going to be playing Dead Man.
Hi, I'm Anne, and I will be Zatanna.
I'm Charlie, and I will be Jason Blood and the Demon Etrigan this evening.
I'm Travis, and I'll be playing Solomon Grundy.
I'm Mary, and I'll be playing Arcane.
I'm Nisha, and I will be Zatara.
All right, well, Eric, take us away.
You got it. Dark Justice, story by Guillermo del Toro, screenplay by Doug Liman and Gary Dauberman. Black screen, title, Dark Justice. Fade in, interior apartment, New Orleans, night. Angle on decayed eye socket, we pull back to see a decomposed skull. A cockroach scurries around inside before sprawling out and dropping down to the floor. It lands and scuttles across the floor before being killed by a cigarette, which is stubbed out on its back. John Constantine, a gaunt, handsome man in his early 30s, sits on the floor with his back against the wall. He looks tired and unkempt. He's seen better days. He reaches into his pocket and removes another cigarette and lights it up. He takes a puff and regards the scene in front of him.
Bollocks.
The room is rotten. The floor and walls are decayed and broken and covered with a creeping black fungus. Fused to the ceiling to the source of the rot, the corpse of Sargon, a formerly powerful sorcerer who is now very dead.
That's your friend?
Must be. He's dead.
You don't seem too broken out.
We wasn't close. It was all right, I suppose. Talked too much.
Well, he's pretty quiet now.
That's an improvement, trust me.
Why so glum, then?
The tosser had to call me for help, didn't he?
And?
You were the last asshole I helped. Look how that turned out.
Suddenly, a transparent, emaciated figure dressed in red leotard with chalk-white skin and deep black eyes floats up through the floor. This is Boston Brand, the dead man.
A beautiful friendship.
A pain in my ass.
Constantine stands up and walks through Brand and under Sargon. He looks up at the corpse above him, then around the room until he spies a broken floorboard. He grabs the board tight and begins to pull it free.
What are you doing?
I have to get the right bastard down, don't I? Not like you're any use.
The board comes loose and almost smacks the magician in the face.
Hey, careful.
Constantine reaches up and bats at the corpse.
Come on, you stubborn prick.
He hits it with one solid smack, and Sargon comes loose. He falls to the floor and bursts open, sending maggots and cockroaches in every direction.
Dirty bastards!
Boston flinches and jumps away from the bugs.
Yeesh.
Why are you crying? You're dead. They can't even touch you. Wimp. Vade.
With that, every cockroach scurries away from Constantine and Sargon's body.
I bet he smells awful.
You'd win that bet. Now for a real trick.
Constantine places the palm of his hand on Sargon's skull and closes his eyes and inhales.
In for sitium Sargamagus.
Nothing happens. Boston smiles.
In for sitium Sargamagus.
Again, nothing.
Impressive.
Usually works like a charm.
What now?
Constantine contemplates for a second.
Let's take him for a stroll.
We're going to do what now?
Constantine grips Sargon's skull by either side and pulls hard, yanking the sorcerer's head clean off with a stomach-turning squelch, falling backward in the process. Exterior Bourbon Street, New Orleans, night. Constantine walks through the crowds of the Big Easy, carrying Sargon's skull underneath his arm. Boston floats beside him.
You're just going to carry that thing around out in the open?
Looks like it.
Not afraid someone will notice?
Been talking to thin air for 3 blocks and no one's batted an eye so far.
Austin spies a young man kissing his girlfriend.
Good point.
Boston takes possession of the young man's body. He pulls away from his very confused girlfriend and follows Constantine. The young man speaks with Boston's voice.
So, where are we headed now?
Gotta take a peek into Sargon's noggin. Can't seem to do it myself.
You losing your touch?
Boston spies on an attractive woman, and grabs her hand.
Piss off. This is Xanadu's turf. I'll see what she has to say.
Boston jumps from the young man's body and into the woman. The young man, disoriented, shakes his head as he finds himself holding Boston / woman in his arms.
Xanadu, are you crazy? She hates you.
Boston / woman lets go of the young man and follows. The young man's girlfriend rushes up to him and slaps him across the face. They argue.
She'll get over it.
She tried to melt you last time.
What are you so worried about?
I like you, John.
Can't imagine why. It's not like we're friends.
Don't have to be. Gotta keep you safe. That's the deal.
Some deal. I don't need a ghost to keep me safe.
You need someone.
Boston jumps from the woman and into a nearby policeman.
I'll bring this one, just in case.
What's that?
Boston, now a cop, pulls his sidearm and waves it around recklessly. Nearby pedestrians run for cover.
If she tries anything, pow.
A gun? It's Xanadu. She'll jam that up the poor bloke's ass.
Boston jumps out of the cop's body, who staggers around disoriented.
Good point.
Exterior, Madame Xanadu's parlor, New Orleans continuous. Constantine stands across from Madame Xanadu's parlor and lights up another cigarette. Boston hovers behind him.
Still think you're making a mistake.
I'm supposed to go see her.
Could be a coincidence.
No such thing. Magic is always wrapped up in itself. Let's go see him, old girl.
Interior, Madame Xanadu's parlor, New Orleans continuous. Xanadu's parlor is filled with all manner of occult objects, from books to bizarre items sealed in jars. Littered around the room are beautiful, vibrant flowers of many varieties. Constantine pushes the door to Xanadu's open slowly and holds the head in front of him.
I come bearing gifts.
Silence. Constantine peeks inside.
Nimue?
He steps inside and the door closes behind him. He takes a few steps inside, then comes to a sudden halt. Frozen in place.
I told you what I'd do if I ever saw you again, John.
Had something to do with evisceration, right?
Yet you come back.
Don't know what eviscerate means. Not scared of syllables, love.
But I know all the right ones. Pavimentium!
Constantine drops to his knees. He drops Sargon's head as he slams his palms against the floor and struggles against the unseen force pulling him down. He looks up to see Sargon's skull being lifted from the floor. Madame Xanadu, a devastatingly beautiful woman in her 30s, holds the skull up to her face. Her eyes are concealed by a silk scarf wrapped around her head.
Sargon! What happened?
He went on a diet. Could you let me up? This is beginning to sting.
Xanadu looks down on Constantine with disdain.
I'm being merciful, John. I should have flayed you for bringing such a foulness here.
Sounds kinky. I need your help.
Why on earth would I help you?
Gratitude. I have been keeping your boyfriend company.
You wouldn't dare.
All it takes is a word, Nim. Now swift are those pretty lips of yours these days.
She releases him and he falls flat on his face.
Be quick.
Constantine gets to his feet and brushes himself off.
You look well.
You look awful. You smell worse.
Classy.
Xanadu places the skull on her neck and takes a seat. She begins to shuffle a stack of tarot cards. Constantine spies a jar on a shelf and picks it up. In the jar floats a disembodied spirit.
You haven't told me what you want.
Clues to the obvious departure of Sargon from this mortal coil. Can I borrow this?
Xanadu wrinkles her nose. Constantine puts it back.
He called me here. Said he needed my help.
Why would you help Sargon of all people?
It's easy. He paid me.
Oh, John.
It's first of the month. Not a lot of demand for an unemployed magician. Money's money. So, Nim, any guess to what happened to him?
Xanadu looks at Sargon's rotted skull.
This is dark magic.
Somebody said that I didn't smell already, love. I can't get a reading off of it. Figured this was your bag.
If this is one of your tricks...
You sounded scared, Nim. Scared enough to ask me for help.
Xanadu contemplates Constantine's request. After a moment, she places both of her hands on Sargon's skull, and her eyes begin to glow beneath her scarf. Lines of energy crisscross down her face, through her arms, and into the skull, which itself begins to glow. Suddenly, the skull turns dark, and the darkness creeps up Xanadu's arms toward her face.
Nim?
Xanadu screams out and pulls away just before the dark energy reaches her eyes. She coughs up a foul black liquid, which dissolves in midair into a dark smoke.
What's the story with that?
It's poison. Nothing left of Sargon.
You didn't see anything?
Nothing.
That adds on the freaky side of things.
What have you gotten yourself into?
Me? I wouldn't do anything but pick up a check. This all stinks of you lot.
You've brought death into my home.
I bring death everywhere, Nim. I have a ghost waiting outside.
No jokes this time. You've been marked.
What does that mean? Listen to the cryptic mumbo-jumbo. Do your tarot card voodoo and figure me a way out.
You don't need to see the future to know what is where this goes. It's the rot.
Well, the other one. Can't be that big. That's heavy hitter stuff. I stay provincial.
Not anymore.
Constantine face palms.
Right.
Really liked him anyway.
You must leave.
His shoulders slump, and he lets out an exaggerated sigh.
Oh, I figured. Good to see you again, Nim. You keep that.
There's no place for it here.
Use it as a paperweight or something. It suits the place. Thanks for not killing me.
Get out!
He leaves the parlor. Exterior Madame Xanadu's parlor, New Orleans, continuous. Constantine exits the parlor, lights up a cigarette, and takes a long puff.
Well, shit.
And Boston materializes beside him.
Well, how'd it go?
You didn't kill me.
She wasn't mad at you?
She is. That's why I'm alive. This way I'll suffer more. But whatever I've got going, it scared her.
Well, what now?
Constantine takes another long puff.
What can one do? Drinks and delirium. To the boozer.
Constantine walks down the street, hunched over, his hands buried in his pockets. Boston follows behind.
Well, if it's as bad as you say, then why not get help? You know enough folks.
The problem is they know me too. Half the bastards would be glad to see me get a right demonic kicking.
I can help.
You can help by pissing off for a bit. I need to be alone.
Boston stops and watches Constantine trudge off.
You're a miserable bastard, John. That's what I love about you.
Constantine ignores him. He continues on. Interior Madame Xanadu's parlor in New Orleans continuous. Xanadu sits, shuffling through her cards. She lays four on the table, face down in front of Sargon's skull, which is facing her. She flips them over one by one, and they reveal themselves in this order. The Magician, the High Priestess, Judgment, and finally, Death.
Oh, John.
Engelon, the cards in Sargon's skull. Suddenly, the skull's milk-white eyes open and focus on Xanadu. She jumps to her feet. A darkness fills the parlor. The door creeps open and all the plants turn black, wither, and die. Cut to interior Moore's bar, night. The bar is dingy, dirty, and deserted. Constantine sits slumped at the counter, looking defeated. The bartender places a double shot of bourbon in front of him.
Cheers.
Constantine opens up with wallet, which is filled with a stack of cutout coupons. He folds two and hands them to the bartender. Bartender holds them up to his face, and the coupons have become crisp $5 bills. Constantine takes a deep puff of the cigarette and exhales. Constantine smiles at his own trick. The bartender takes the coupons and leaves. Boston appears on the stool beside Constantine.
This has to be the crappiest bar in existence.
It was the emptiest.
Even though I can't touch anything, I'm still afraid to touch anything.
Thought I told you to piss off.
I didn't think getting drunk is going to help.
Doesn't hurt.
Your liver might disagree.
The liver might disagree.
You're just jealous I have one.
There's some Billy I could borrow anytime I want.
Lucky you.
Bartender side-eyes Constantine, who appears to be having a conversation with himself.
Maybe it's not so bad. She could have been lying.
Madame Xanadu doesn't lie. The truth hurts, unfortunately.
What now?
Go home.
Then what?
Kick back, have a drink, watch the world end.
Sounds like a plan, I guess.
Constantine jumps off the stool and walks toward the exit.
No, mate. Plans are what you make before everything goes to shit.
Son of a bitch!
Constantine looks around and sees the bartender gesturing toward the entrance. The door is a vagrant. He looks sick.
I told you not to come in here anymore. Damn bums always trying to stink up the place.
He grabs the vagrant roughly toward the around the collar and tries to drag him toward the door. The vagrant's shirt is torn, and this reveals that half his body is rotting away. His face twists in pain and terror, and he vomits up a black vial fixed with maggots all over the bartender. The bartender screams out in disgust and horror. The smell is disgusting, and Constantine covers his mouth. A large pulsating thing erupts out of the vagrant's maw and lands on the floor. The vagrant falls dead and twitching beside the thing on the floor. Something inside the horrible sack starts to grow drastically and rips out of its slimy outer membrane. A creature emerges. It raises up itself to Constantine's height. It is a combination of rotten flesh, sinewy limbs, and rows of jagged teeth. This is a rotling. It gets to its feet and focuses its milky, lifeless eyes on Constantine.
Constantine!
Right.
His attention is turned to the bartender, who is now holding his stomach and screaming in agony.
Help me!
As soon as he gets the words out, his stomach tears open and cockroaches and maggots creep up his body and into his eyes. Jeez. A rotling's arm protrudes from his chest and another creature rips its way out of the screaming bartender. The first rotling lunges at Constantine, who raises his hands and catches the slavering beast on either side of the jaw.
Boston!
The beast's stinking maw is inches away from Constantine's face. Boston takes possession of the rotling, but is quickly spat back out.
That's awful.
You are no bloody use.
Constantine pushes the creature off of him and grabs a nearby glass of beer. He puts his palm over the rim and shakes it. The fluid turns blue. He throws the contents at the rotling.
Es frigidus!
The creature freezes as soon as the fluid touches it. Constantine grabs a bar stool and swings it into the creature, shattering into pieces.
What about that one?
Constantine looks at the second rotling, which has grown to full size. It's even more gruesome and misshapen than the first. He lifts the stool into attack position.
One moment.
Before he can engage the creature, four more rotlings crash through the bar windows and surround Constantine. He calculates his odds before dropping the stool. He jumps over the bar and runs into the kitchen. He slams the door shut behind him.
Signalum ostium.
The door fuses to the wall. The rotlings slam against the door, but they can't break through. Constantine leans back against the door and slumps to the ground. He removes a cigarette and begins to light it up, but pauses as he sees the short order cook and two cleaners surrounded by rotlings. The poor souls are infected and convulsing as streams of cockroaches erupt from their mouths and eyes, followed by rotling sacks.
Piss off!
The door behind him starts to crack and break. The magician sighs and slowly gets to his feet.
Right.
He pulls a bag of dust from his inside pocket, crushes it between his fists, and raises them above his head.
Sanctum exudo!
Just as the Rotlings are about to pounce, his fists burn bright and a white fire spreads forth. Every window and door in the building explodes in a blinding white fire. The Rotlings are vaporized in the fire, which after a moment dissipates, leaving Constantine and Boston untouched and surrounded by smoldering remains of the hideous abominations. The whole room hisses. He kicks a heap of smoldering bones across the kitchen.
Could you have done that any time?
Shut up.
Suddenly, the entire building shakes as one of the walls is completely demolished. Constantine is thrown backwards onto the floor. The dust settles, and standing in the middle of the destruction is a hulking, gray-skinned, corpse-like monster with symbol carved into his flesh and mostly likely a noose around his neck. This is Solomon Grundy. Okay. Grundy lunges forward and attacks. Constantine jumps out of the way just in time to avoid the strike that demolishes the bar, sending splinters of wood and shards of glass through the air. Boston attempts to possess the monster, but upon touching his hide, is struck by waves of energy. The dead man screams out in pain and is flung back. The zombie grabs Constantine's forearm and swings him around like a doll, snapping. Constantine screams in agony. Grundy backhands the magician, knocking him out. He goes limp. The zombie releases his grip and Constantine slumps to the floor. The monster grabs him by the ankle and begins to drag him toward the door. Boston reappears and sees that his friend is captured. He quickly jumps into Constantine's body. Boston slash Constantine's eyes snap open and he looks around and grabs a broken bottle from the floor. He slashes savagely at Grundy's fingers and cuts himself free. Grundy looks at his mutilated hand and with indifference before attempting to grab his quarry again. Boston slash Constantine, now possessed of Boston's acrobatic ability, kips up from the floor and sidesteps Grundy's grasp. He then runs up the zombie's arm and somersaults towards over him. He winces in pain and he lands and clutches his broken arm.
Being alive hurts.
Nice. He dashes outside where he sees both ends of the street are blocked by hordes of Rotlings, larger and more grotesque than before. Boston slash Constantine slaps himself repeatedly.
Wake up, John!
Dead man! Give us the magician! Let the rot embrace him!
Can't do that.
Done Tuesday.
What?
Christian Done Tuesday.
Thank you. Boston slash Constantine looks behind him and sees Grundy advancing. As the Rotlings advance, the ground beneath their feet is consumed by creeping black decay. Boston slash Constantine runs toward a group of Rotlings and with acrobatic grace parkours his way over them, jumping from a dumpster, then swinging from a fire escape and landing gracefully behind them. He sprints out of the alley and out into the street. Grundy gives chase, trampling the Rotlings under his feet. Boston slash Constantine finds himself on Bourbon Street, surrounded by revelers. He runs down the street, holding his broken limb tied to his body. As he goes, he bumps into revelers.
Sorry.
Grundy appears in the street and tosses pedestrians aside. He charges after Boston slash Constantine. He is followed by the Rotlings who scramble after him. Boston slash Constantine finds himself in a busy vehicle congested street and jumps from car bonnet to car roof as he makes his way across. Grundy follows, destroying and crushing the cars as he charges, literally tossing them aside. Boston slash Constantine screeches to a halt when he sees that his path is blocked by more Rotlings. Behind him, Grundy and Rotlings close on him. He's cornered. The possessed magician backs away across the street. The zombie attacks.
See you soon, John.
A woman's voice echoes through the night.
Poor Daniel.
A bright light flashes, and the eyes of the Rotlings burn in their sockets. Boston/Constantine shields his eyes against the light. From above appears a beautiful Latin woman in her 20s, dressed in the manner of a 1980s rocker chick. This is Zatanna. She lands directly in front of Grundy, standing defiant in before the hulking zombie. She looks tiny compared to the massive undead monster.
Married on a Wednesday.
Du nuag elemberk.
She snaps her fingers and the ground beneath Grundy gives way and he falls beneath the surface. Zatanna turns her attention to Boston/Constantine.
John.
Not exactly.
Tana looks at him confused for a moment before her attention is turned to the rotlings, which are writhing and convulsing. Their mouths split open and bodies burst like ripe fruit as thousands of cockroaches spew forth onto the street and towards Zatanna and Boston/Constantine. Zatanna pulls the possessed magician close.
That trap, Ikatsu Emma.
She snaps her fingers again and a swirling blue vortex appears beneath their feet and they fall down into it. Cut to interior libraries. Zatara's manor. Continuous. In a flash of light, Zatanna and Boston/Constantine appear in the middle of a huge circular library, which is filled with books from floor to ceiling. Boston/Constantine falls to his knees and vomits. He rubs his mouth and looks up at Zatanna, nauseous and in pain.
I think I'll go back to being dead now, if you don't mind.
His eyes roll back in his head and he falls into unconsciousness. Cut to interior cell, Ravenscar Asylum. Angle on Constantine's eyes as they flicker open. He finds himself hanging from shackles in the middle of a cell with dirty white tiles. He is soaked in water and dripping on the floor. The door to the cell opens and Dr. Huntoon, a tall, bespectacled man, enters.
Good morning, John. How are you feeling today?
Constantine looks around scared and confused.
Not supposed to be here? John, we've talked about this.
Constantine tugs in his shackles.
You remember Astra, don't you?
Constantine stops struggling.
Not my fault. I tried.
But it is, John. It is. That poor little girl is in hell. And it's all your fault.
No.
Huntoon grabs Constantine's face roughly with both hands, prying his jaw open. Huntoon's eyes begin to sink into his head and then turn black.
She's being torn to pieces over and over again. And it's all your fault.
Constantine tries to scream. Huntoon's jaw starts to hyperextend as he vomits bile into Constantine's open mouth. Cut to interior guest bedroom, Satara's manor, night. Constantine wakes with a start. He sits up in bed. He touches his arm, which is completely healed, as are all his wounds. His clothes are cleaned and neatly folded on a nearby chair. He snatches them up. Interior hallway, Satara's manor, continuous. Constantine, fully dressed, exits the bedroom. He hears the sounds of laughter coming from down the hall and follows it. He finds himself back in the library where Zatanna is sitting cross-legged on a table drinking tea and enjoying a joke with Boston.
And it did it wakes.
See?
John?
What happened? Last thing I remember, I was snapped like a twig.
I saved you. Z helped.
Z? Thought I was the one who called you that.
Once upon a time.
Thanks for the help. You coming?
He turns to leave.
Xanadu is missing.
Disinterested, John searches through his pockets and finds his cigarettes.
Awful shame. What a delightful girl.
She was your friend, John.
Only when threatening to kill me. Thanks for the help, but I have a mark on my head and Xanadu is in no rush to help me. We all have our problems.
Where are we, anyway?
My father's house.
Oh, looks different from the last time he kicked me out of it. Never thought I'd visit again. Must be mellowing in his old age.
He's dying.
That'll do it.
He wants to see you.
Can't imagine why.
Please, John.
Constantine contemplates for a moment. Boston does a, come on, shrug.
for me.
Why not?
Zatanna leaves the library. Constantine follows. Interiors Zatara's chambers, Zatara's manor, continuous. Zatanna slowly pushes the bedroom door open and peeks inside. The room is lit by the flickering, crackling flames of the fireplace. Above the fireplace is a large framed family portrait. Giovanni Zatara, a tall, handsome man with dark hair and a strong build. Zatanna, age 5, and a beautiful and striking woman with snow white hair. Zatanna's mother, Sindela.
Dad? Oh my God, Dad, are you there?
Come in. Come in.
Zatanna opens the door fully and steps inside, followed by Constantine.
I'll be with you in a moment.
Put that out.
Constantine removes the cigarette from his mouth and looks around awkwardly for a place to stub it out.
No need. Still smoking, John? Those things?
Zatanna steps into view. He's emaciated, skeletal, his skin dry and tight to his body, a stark contrast to the powerful man in the portrait. Despite his withered and weakened exterior, he smiles warmly.
Those things will kill you.
Constantine can't hide his shock at Zatara's appearance.
But so will magic, no?
May the worst one win.
Sooner or later. One always does. Give us a moment. John and I have much to talk about.
Zatanna nods and leaves the room, closes the door behind her.
Please, sit.
Constantine takes a seat. Zatanna sits across from him. There is a silence for a moment.
You've lost weight.
Zatanna smiles.
You haven't changed, John.
Last time I saw you, you had a little more color in your face.
I'm dying, John.
Yeah, that'll do it.
Comes to us all in the end.
I'm still looking for loopholes.
It was the rot, John. I was unprepared. I fought it as best I could. I escaped, but I feel I am paying the price.
It's nothing you can't fix.
Not this time. I'm afraid I won't be alone in my fate. It has come for us all.
I don't believe it. It's all too big even for you. What do we matter to the rot?
When it came, I heard a voice. It wants what you hid all those years ago.
It used Sargon to bring me to New Orleans. I went and led it to Xanadu. Shite!
We need your help.
Funny that. As I recall, you threw me out of here when I asked for the same.
You asked for the impossible.
Nothing's impossible for the great Giovanni Zatara. You just didn't want to do it even after what I did for you and the others.
Now is not the time to hold on to old grudges.
I'm not holding a grudge. I just remember what a wanker you were.
I'm sorry for what happened.
Sorry for what, exactly? Tossing me out on the street or turning your back on me? Everyone's sorry when they need something.
It needs you to find its prize. And if you fall, the world falls with you.
All I needed was the rent.
You can't talk your way out of it this time. There's a shadow on you and it will follow wherever you run.
Give me the key then. I'll stay at the house.
My body is failing, not my reason. My daughter has the key and she will not part with it.
Right. That's that then.
Zatara, with much effort, gets to his feet. He places his hands on Constantine's shoulders. The magician looks at the decaying skin, his former mentor's limbs.
You can't run away from this, John.
Did you ever stop to think maybe this might be your problem? I haven't been messing with magic half as long as the old tossers, but I've lost twice as much. Why me? Why don't you ask the heavy hitters?
All gone. Everyone is gone.
Everyone?
We wish to spare the world our fate. And if you look inside yourself, I believe you would want the same.
Well, don't tug on my heartstrings. They're not attached to anything.
This darkness is coming for us all, you especially. If I can't plead to your better nature, I'll speak to your selfishness.
That's known to work.
The rot is spreading. I feel it. Soon it will consume everything, including you. Help save the world, John, if only by saving yourself.
Constantine leans back into his chair, contemplating Zatara's words. Interior hallway, Zatara's manner continuous. Constantine steps out of Zatara's room. Zatanna stands waiting. There is a moment of awkward silence.
Piss off, Boston.
And Boston faces out of the wall.
Sorry.
The dead man drifts down the hallway and then disappears.
Must be hard seeing him like that.
Doesn't have much time left.
I wouldn't worry about it. He's a crafty old bloke. He's beaten worse.
Not this time.
You weren't always so pessimistic.
You weren't always such a bad liar.
He shoves his hand in his pockets and looks away from her eyes.
Never had to lie to you before.
A moment passes.
You stay?
He notices something on her neck and pushes aside her collar to expose a chain around her neck. He tugs on it and reveals a golden key hangs from it.
Great and scary things. He wants to see you.
She covers the key and enters Zatara's room. Interior Zatara's chamber, Zatara's manner continuous. Zatara sits in front of the fireplace, gazing into the flames. Zatanna sits at his side. Zatara looks up the portrait of Sindela, his eyes full of sadness and regret. Zatanna takes his frail, withered hand in hers.
I'm sorry.
Sorry for?
I do. I have made a great many mistakes, and I fear you will pay for them, like your mother did.
There's still hope.
Zatara squeezes her hand as his gaze drifts off and he watches the light from the fire flicker across the ceiling, casting strange shapes.
Light and shadow, and the universe goes dark. I fear I have not thought you enough.
John will help us. I know he will.
Interior library, Zatara's manor. Continuous. Constantine sits on a table, rolling the gem he threatened Xanadu with in the palm of his hand. Boston hovers beside him.
What are you thinking?
Thinking I'm in the wrong line of work.
He's nice. Why would you ever mention him before?
She must have slipped my mind.
If you say so, I like her.
Get in line, dead man.
Any odd cut, your ship has already sailed for you.
And how would you know?
Perks of possession. Got a little bit of you when I was pulling your strings.
Don't go playing Geppetto with my bones again, mate.
Fine. Next time a zombie beats you like a speed bag, I'll take a knee.
There won't be a next time, trust me. We best get a move on.
We're not staying?
Constantine puts the gem back in his pocket.
Not bloody likely. Giovanni Zatara may have one foot in the grave, but he has one hand out, and that's more than enough to stab me in the back. Again, bastard has some cheek asking me to help.
What about Z?
What about her? Don't let those pretty eyes fool you. She's just like her old man. She'll only let you close enough to stick the knife in. Zatara left me to rot. So it's only fair I return the favor.
Both man and ghost turn to see Zatanna standing in the doorframe.
See, I'm...
She storms out. Constantine follows.
Z, I didn't mean...
He puts his hand on her shoulder.
Teg for me, M.
A flash of energy sends Constantine flying backwards. A portal opens behind him and he flies through it and skids across the wet, dirty concrete of a New York City alleyway. He lies on his back and rain pours down on him. Constantine POV, Boston appears above him.
Move.
And the portal closes. Interior Zatara's chamber, Zatara's manor, continuous. Zatara is still in front of the fire. The rot has spread more now. Zatanna enters the room.
Where is Constantine?
I sent him home.
Zatara turns around in his chair.
We need him.
He's still the same selfish, stubborn idiot he always was.
He's reliable in that regard.
has to be another way.
He is a fool, yet a fool can do good, if only by accident.
Tana touches the key on her neck.
I can't do this, Dad. I'm not like you.
No, you're like your mother, and that gives me hope.
He becomes weak and staggers forward. Satana rushes to his side and catches him.
Go to John. Try to reach him, but do not trust him, for he does not trust himself.
Satana hugs his daughter tight. Cut to an exterior Brooklyn Bridge, New York City night. The rain is worse now. Constantine walks across the bridge toward Brooklyn with his hands in his pockets, looking miserable. Boston floats beside him. Time stops. The rain drops, stop in midair. Boston is frozen in place.
Hello, Johnny boy.
Standing before him is a grinning, cruel-looking man dressed in a long green coat. This is Neron, a demon from hell. The raindrops evaporate in his presence, leaving him wrapped in an aura of steam.
Oh no, a demon.
Word is you're in trouble, kiddo.
That good news travels fast. Your boss still mad at me?
Oh, he's always mad. The whole ultimate evil thing. He's not about the one you should be worried about.
Your side okay with someone else kicking off the apocalypse?
The dead come to us anyway. The green, the rot. It doesn't matter who sends them.
Can't imagine it would.
How is the great John Constantine going to get himself out of this one?
I have a few ideas.
I have a suggestion.
I'm sure you do.
Don't say no straight away. Hear me out.
That soul's not for sale.
I can get you a good price. Solve all your problems.
Still trying for that promotion.
I'm swimming with sharks. The soul of John Constantine would really evaluate my stock.
At least it's worth something.
Relatively speaking.
Still no.
You're a drunk, immoral con artist. You're going to end up downstairs anyway. You might as well get something out of the deal.
Maybe next time. See you around, Neron.
Neron looks dejected for a moment before a cruel smile creeps across his face.
Astra still calls your name.
Constantine stops in his tracks.
Between the screams.
He vanishes. Jackass. Time resumes. The rain falls again. Constantine continues on to Brooklyn, followed by Boston, who is unaware of what just happened. Cut to exterior street Brooklyn. Night. A portal opens as Atana steps out onto the street. She looks up at the stormy sky.
Alarum. Alarum move.
She snaps her fingers and the transparent outline of an umbrella appears above her head, shielding her from the rain. Interior Midnight's Bar Night. Midnight's is no different from any other hole in the wall bar in New York, except it is menagerie of bizarre and otherworldly figures, from a hulking blue devil with spectacular white horns to what looked like Frankenstein's monster with a mohawk. The bar is home to the fantastic and the frightening. I'm gonna go to this bar. Constantine, soaked to the bone, enters the bar. He navigates his way through the patrons. Boston phases through the door and follows him. The bartender, Velcoro, a thin, raggedy looking vampire in aviator goggles, nods at Constantine, who takes a seat at the bar beside a chimp in a deer hunter cap. They nod to one another.
Off night.
You look good, Velcoro. You get a tan.
The vampire smiles, revealing fangs, oh shocker, and pours Constantine a shot of whiskey. Angle on TV. Behind the bar, the TV plays a news report. It reads New Orleans outbreak. Behind the serious-looking reporters, CDC agents in hazmat suits cordon off Bourbon Street. Constantine watches the report as he lifts the whiskey to his lips.
I got this.
Constantine looks to his side as Ellie, a gorgeous demon with a prehensile tail, saunters up to him.
Thank you. Why?
I figured you need it. I hear you're in a bit of a fix.
What changes?
Nothing but the weather.
Everyone this side of the afterlife seems privy to my predicament, it seems.
It's quite the conversation starter.
I'd have appreciated a heads up, that's all I'm saying.
Nobody likes you.
Constantine looks over his shoulder and sees that everyone in the bar has their eyes on him. He turns back to his drink.
The apocalypse seems overkill. I don't think I pissed everyone off that much.
Ellie smiles and raises an eyebrow as if to say, really?
Well, you might be right. Here's to hell freezing over. Cheers, love.
Exterior, Midnight's Bar, Brooklyn, continuous. The rain has stopped. Zatanna makes her way to the bar. The doorman blocks her way.
Not tonight. Private bar.
Thanos POV. The glamour around the doorman fades and he is revealed to be a demon.
My friend's in there. I'll only be a minute.
The demon doorman puts his hand on Satana's shoulder.
I said not tonight.
Interior, Midnight's bar continuous. The sound of something big being thrown into what sounds like trash cans can be heard from outside. Bakoro looks up inquisitively as Zatanna comes through the bar, the door.
Oh, hey.
Private bar.
Relax, Druncula. I'm with him.
Ellie hisses at Zatanna, removes her tail, which had been wrapped around Constantine's waist, and slinks away into the crowd.
Can a man not just have a drink anymore? I'm assuming you're here to apologize?
I'd rather eat broken glass.
Fair enough. I'll leave you in Boston alone then. Have a drink and bitch about me.
He walks past Zatanna and out the door.
I'm down.
Outside the bar, Constantine pauses to light up a cigarette and glances at the doorman, who's upside down in a trash can down the street. Smoke rises from his burnt trousers. Zatanna exits the bar. Boston phases through the door behind her.
Why do you have to be such an asshole?
Consistency.
But I need your help, and you need mine.
Debatable.
You can't hope to fight this on your own. What do you think you can do?
Honestly? Run away.
There's nowhere to run to.
I hear Atlantis is nice this time of year.
This isn't you. Where's the Constantine I used to know? Where's the man who beat the devil?
Tricked the devil. And that guy is long gone.
Zatanna steps in front of Constantine, blocking his path.
Come on, Z, what do you want from me?
To get through to you. Convince you to do the right thing.
By whose definition?
He continues past her.
Every single sorcerer and magician worth anything is dead or missing. Jason Blood.
An arsehole.
Sargon.
Another arsehole.
Xanadu.
Queen of arseholes.
We're the only ones left.
Wouldn't mind being the last.
Anna is aghast at Constantine's indifference.
What happened in New Orleans is going to happen everywhere if you don't help me tonight. This evil, this rot will consume everything you care about.
There are powers in place to deal with this stuff beyond people like us, even your old man. What do you want from me?
Dad told me you hid something. Something that can help us stop it.
Yeah, I hid something for him. Didn't happen to tell you what it was, did he?
Tana looks away from his gaze.
But he told you I would. Sneaky old bastard. The great and powerful Zatera. Self-righteous, manipulative. Cruel. Truth is, I couldn't stand your old man, Z. Only put up with his shite for two reasons. One of them was you. He always knew that, too.
Constantine looks into Zatanna's eyes and contemplates for a moment.
Shite. Come on, then.
Where?
Home. My feet are wet. Can't think straight with wet feet.
He continues on. His footsteps are loud squelches. Boston watches them leave, then floats away in the opposite direction. Exterior, Constantine's house, Brooklyn, continuous. Constantine's house is located on a residential Brooklyn street. The house is a two-story detached family home in a sly case of disrepair. Constantine, followed by Zatanna, walks up the front steps and puts his keys in the lock. He struggles to open it. His neighbor and landlord, Mrs. M, appears next door.
Is that Mr. Constantine?
I'll have the rent to you in the morning.
Oh, that's fine. How was your trip?
Not great. Pretty rotten, actually.
Oh, that's a shame. Well, there's always next time.
The world might be ending. I'll let you know.
He finally unlocks the door and steps inside. Cut to exterior busy street, lower Manhattan, night. Boston floats down the busy street through the crowds of people until he stops in front of a coffee shop. He looks in through the window at dawn, a pretty young woman in her 20s. She's a waitress and serves customers their orders. Boston watches her go back and forth. It's clear he yearns to speak to her. She places a cup of coffee on a table in front of a handsome man of similar age. The young man smiles at her. She politely smiles back before turning away.
I miss you, Don.
She recognizes the voice and turns around.
Excuse me?
The handsome man shakes his head, disoriented and confused by what just happened to him. Boston is back outside, looking in at dawn, with eyes full of sadness. He takes one last look and floats away. Interior living room, Constantine's house, night. Satana looks at a display of framed photos on Constantine's living room wall. Angle on photos. There are framed pictures of Constantine with his sister Cheryl and niece Gemma. Another with his friend Chaz, a burly dark-haired man. Another of a very young Constantine with his band, Mucus Membrane. Nice. And lastly, one of Zatanna and himself, younger, happier, and clearly in love.
What are memories on that wall?
Zatanna looks around to see Constantine watching her.
Good ones?
Depends who's asking.
Zatanna looks around the room. Constantine's house is slightly messy, clearly the living space of a single man. The walls have occult symbols and wards painted on them.
I like your place. It's cozy.
It's cheap.
I thought you didn't like New York.
I don't.
Why didn't you go back to England?
I did, for a bit.
What happened?
Came back for a funeral. Ended up staying. Obligations to the departed.
Must have been a good friend.
You seem to like him.
Boston?
The great Boston Brand. Not just a dickhead spirit, but once world famous trapeze artist.
Cut to interior circus. Boston, alive and happy, flies high above the crowd as he swings from the trapeze. There is no net, just the rope and the ground. The crowd is in awe and applauds at his every move. Boston soaks in their admiration. He loves the praise.
Oh, really went splat.
Cut to a gunshot rings out. The rope snaps and Boston plummets to the floor. The audience screams. Cut to living room. Zatanna holds a framed photo in her hands. Angle on photo. It's of Constantine and Boston when he was alive, taking a candid in the bar.
Somebody did it to him, so I felt I had some obligation to put that right. So I invoked the Hindu goddess Ramakrishna. Figured for a little song, dance, and sacrifice, she'd bring him up, we'd have banter, and I'd go about putting it right. So, bloody luck.
Didn't go as planned?
What do you think? She bonded me to the bastard, which sticks until I find who offed him. Which is unlikely, since all he remembers is hitting the dirt. So I'm stuck with him. And he never stops talking.
You're never lonely, at least.
Not lately.
He has some power, and we will need all the help we can get.
Constantine thinks for a moment and rubs the red gem between his fingers.
Come with me to my basement. Keep all my worst stuff down there.
Interior, Zatara's chambers, Zatara's manor, night. Zatara stands by the window, looking out into the night, his infection having spread even further.
Cinderella, she was so beautiful.
Tara turns slowly, standing by the fireplace, looking up at the family portrait is a figure wrapped in shadow, its face concealed beneath a stag's skull. its antlers fashioned into a macabre crown.
How she vexed me in life.
What have you become?
We do what we must to endure and have endured, old friend.
I know what you want. I promise you, you won't find it here.
You put your faith in a child, Zatara. You've doomed her just as you've doomed Cinderella.
Don't speak her name.
It is ever upon my lips. She set me free. Although I doubt that was her intention, I promised you your daughter beg for death will never come. She will be the vessel of my retribution, and my friend shall watch.
Your words are as hollow as your soul.
Tara waves his hand in the theatrical manner of a stage magician. Magical energy illuminates his fists and the room around him. He stands ready for battle.
Oh, the memories.
Light and shadow and the universe goes dark.
The figure charges at Zatara, who leaps to meet him. Cut to interior basement, Constantine's house, night. Constantine's basement is a goldmine of the occult akin to Xanadu's, except nowhere near as organized. Magical potions and artifacts are strewn about, including an ancient Roman spear. Angle on, a sledgehammer crashes against concrete. Constantine's sleeves rolled up and sweating, brings the hammer down again and again as he breaks through a thin layer of cement to reveal a secret area underneath. He pauses and looks at Zatara, who's watching, sipping on a cup of tea.
Couldn't have made me a cuppa.
Oh, you only had one used tea bag. It's as weak as water.
That's how I like it.
Zatara looks around the room at the empty and half-empty bottles of whiskey that are shown about.
I figured you for stronger tastes.
On cold nights.
How long are your winters?
Year-round!
Brings the hammer down and breaks the cement completely. With the concrete brushed aside, we see a large wooden coffin adorned with occult symbols. He kicks the lid off to reveal a body inside, a man in his early 30s with a streak of white hair down the middle of his auburn locks. Zatara recognizes the man.
That's...
Last favor I did for Xanadu, before your dad gave me the boot. This is Jason Blood.
You imprisoned him?
Contained.
He's been missing for 5 years. What the hell is wrong with you?
Hey, don't blame me, Z. I may have put him away for a bit, but I was just doing what I was told.
Xanadu loved Jason.
You only hurt the ones you love. Especially if he shares his soul with a hellspawn.
Hellspawn?
Where are my manners? Zatara, Zatara, meet Etrigan the Demon.
The Demon Knight.
Yeah, the very same. You see, what people don't know is that Etrigan shares Jason's soul. Has done for quite some time. 1,500 years or more. He also loves Xanadu. Maybe a bit too much. Caused quite a bit of trouble. So she comes to me and asks me to put him away for a bit until they figure out how to separate them. They never did.
You're going to release him?
Bingo.
But if he's so dangerous...
The world might be about to end, and I have you, a ghost, and a hangover that won't go away. I need a little dangerous. Hand me that.
She gives him the bottle, and he takes a deep swig.
Let's stand well back. Concierge, concierge, ambre anima habite!
He stomps down on the gem hard, shattering it. Silence. Constantine steps back.
Wait for it.
Suddenly, Jason's body starts convulsing violently. He emits a chilling scream, and a rising red energy seeps out of his mouth and eyes. The coffin explodes in the room and is engulfed in the same energy, sending Constantine's stand up flying back. The energy dissipates, and Jason Blood, awake and angry, rises slowly from the coffin.
Constantine.
Constantine gets to his feet.
Let me explain.
Jason charges toward him.
Bollocks.
Jason lands a right cross across Constantine's jaw, sending the magician staggering backwards. Zatanna raises out her hand toward him.
Jason!
Zatara's daughter? You're a part of this?
I know you're angry, but you have to listen to me.
I will, after I kick every one of this bastard's teeth out.
Yes, let's...
Jason freezes.
Of your father's powers, but none of his wisdom.
Constantine stands and rubs his jaw.
Thanks, Z. Snobby wanker.
Stop!
He hit me!
You imprisoned me.
Contained! And you deserved it, you naughty, naughty boy.
Jason, with great discomfort, lunges forward and snatches Constantine by the throat, lifting him up from the floor. He begins to squeeze.
I deserved to be betrayed?
That's what I'm good at!
Jason squeezes harder.
Xanadu's been taken.
Boy.
He lets go of Constantine, who falls flat on his ass, holding his throat. Zatanna releases Jason, who drops to one knee. Boston phases through a wall, shoulders slumped, looking depressed. Jason looks right at him.
You are.
You can see me too? Awesome. It's two new friends I made today.
Exterior street, New York City, night. It's a deserted street. Steam wafts off from beneath a manhole. An NYPD cruiser is parked and two cops sip coffee inside. The manhole is pushed open violently and flies through the air and lands on the windscreen of the cop car. The alarm breaks the night's silence. The cops jump out of the vehicle and watch as Solomon Grundy emerges from the sewer, wearing the Sargon skull around his neck. His broad shoulders, unable to fit through the hole, crack the concrete as he rises. The cops pull their weapons and train them on Grundy, who at first doesn't notice them.
Just hold it right there, big guy.
Anyway, Grundy turns toward the cops and walks slowly toward them. Take it easy, Frankenstein! Grundy comes to a halt, just inches away from the barrels of their guns. Sargon's eyes suddenly appear in his skull. The cops give each other a puzzle, terrified looks. Grundy grabs cop number one's arm and lifts him off his feet. Cop number two unloads the gun into Grundy's chest. Sargon's skull spits black bile into cop number two's face. It begins to rot away his skin and he falls on his back, pawing his decomposing face. Cop number one watches in horror as Sargon turns his attention to him and spits the rotting fluid on him. It continues to consume him. Starts to consume him. Grundy rips the cop's arm out of the socket and removes Sargon from around his neck. He then jams the stump into the base of the skull. Whoa. Tendrils of rot creep down the arm and it springs to life. Sargon, now using the arm's hand as transport, scurries down the street, followed by Grundy. The two cops convulse on the ground before rotlings erupt into their bodies. Dang. Interior, basement, Constantine's house, night. Constantine sits on the floor with his back against the wall, smoking. Zatanna sits on a chair while Boston hovers beside her. Jason has his back turned to them, looking down on his own coffin.
Who would have the power to take Nimue?
Rumor is it's the Rot.
Lies.
That's what I thought. It's not just her, all the old guard are missing. Only the worst of the worst could pull that off.
The Green wouldn't allow it. Have you spoken to him?
The Swamp Thing? Not lately.
You betray him too?
Haven't found the time yet.
I should kill you, Constantine.
That makes you special, does it?
This one's getting angry.
Was it my idea to lock you up? You want someone to be angry, I'd be angry at Nim. If we can find her.
One does not go to war with the Rot.
Doesn't look like you have much of a choice. You need us to find your lady, and we need that bloke that shares your noggin.
Etrigan.
Constantine puts his cigarette out and stands up.
Don't go unleashing the hellfire yet. I bet he's more pissed at me than you are.
Not by much. The Green must know what's happening.
If he does, he hasn't done anything about it.
Why don't you ask?
Constantine shoots his friend a disapproving look.
Dead man has a point.
Not that simple.
No, it never is.
Suddenly, a cockroach scurries across the floor slowly. Boston sees it. Nobody else notices.
John?
I'm not on such good terms with the Green guy these days. Have you ever actually met him?
John?
Proper wanker most of the time.
John?
You would think a talking plant would have a sense of humor.
John!
What?
Boston points to the ceiling.
That ain't right.
Constantine, Zatanna, and Jason look up at the ceiling and see that it is slowly being consumed by thousands of cockroaches.
A plan?
Pull up our socks and run.
That works.
Constantine heads for the door. As he reaches toward the handle, maggots start to stream from the keyhole and roaches creep under the floor.
Shite.
Boom! The door explodes and shards of wood, chunks of concrete fly through the air. Constantine is thrown onto his back. One large chunk of concrete cracks Jason across the forehead as he falls backward back into his former prison. Standing in the doorway, flanked by a group of rotlings, is Solomon Grundy. Sargon is perched on his shoulder.
Nice to see you again, John.
Constantine notices that his Mrs. M is with them, infected and beginning to rot.
Oh, you double-crossing dead bastard.
Just give us what we want and accept the inevitable.
Grundy, followed by the rotlings, advances toward Constantine. Constantine looks around and spies the spear. He jumps to his feet and snatches it up and points it threateningly at Grundy.
Aha!
Neither Grundy nor Sargon are intimidated.
Pointy stick. I was spending a little more from the great John Constantine.
Constantine smiles and swings the spear at Grundy as if teeing off on a golf course. It connects with a flash of light and sends the zombie flying through the air, knocking over the rotling, shattering the ceiling, and out into the street.
How about that, you ugly little prick?
Holy shit.
Spear of destiny.
No way. Would you get it?
No, I want to bet.
Zatanna is seeing to the fallen Jason. She lifts him to his feet. He's groggy.
Help me with him.
Constantine rushes to her side and assists her. The rotlings start to rise as Constantine and Zatanna drag Jason past. They climb out of the hole Grundy left in the side of the building to find the hulking zombie has regained himself and hundreds more rotlings have appeared. Sargon scurries around Grundy's feet.
Right now would be a great time to work that backwards mojo.
Before Zatanna can speak, Sargon spits a blob of spiders into Zatanna's face. Oh my God. And she is sent back into the nearby wall, clawing at the thousands of arachnids which have engulfed her mouth and, oh God, reading this, creeps down her neck, seemingly consuming her. Constantine rushes to her aid and lets Jason drop to his knees. The rotlings swarm them, and Constantine swings the spear left and right, tearing limbs of the rotted clean off. The rotlings surround Jason. He fends them off as well as he can, but he is being overwhelmed. Their jagged claws slice the meat off his forearm. Before they can swarm, he slams his hands down into the street beneath him, cracking the asphalt. The heat from his body causing the tar to bubble and pop. He opens his eyes, which have now turned blood red.
Gone, the form of man.
Yes. His body begins to warp and change shape. He starts to get larger, and his skin begins to turn yellow. Horns erupt from his forehead as he lets out a blood-curdling roar, revealing razor-sharp fangs. A huge explosion of flaming energy erupts, sending the rotling horde through the air. Jason Blood is gone. In his place is the demon Etrigan.
Rise, the demon Etrigan!
About bloody time.
About bloody time. Etrigan spies Constantine.
You!
Oh, shit. Look, I know you're mad, but that guy just slapped Nimue's ass.
Lady Xanadu?
What are you going to do about it?
Grundy stomps toward the Hellspawn.
Come, come, the living dead, so Etrigan can smash and crush your head.
Grundy throws a punch at the demon, who grabs his fist and counters with a crushing blow of his own. He doesn't even stagger the zombie. Oh, crap. They exchange devastating strikes before Etrigan tackles Grundy and slams him through an adjacent building. Constantine places the palm on his hand over Zatanna's mouth. Her eyes are bugging out as the thousands of spiders are suddenly suffocating her.
Hold on there, Z. I got this. Ready for us!
The spiders are pulled from Zatanna's body and become a ball in the palm of Constantine's hand. Zatanna coughs and gasps for air.
Body!
They burn up in a ball of flame.
We're good.
Not that good, John.
Constantine looks up and sees the rotlings have surrounded them.
How are you feeling, Z?
Been better.
Oh, God, Zatanna. Constantine looks around and sees Sargon's rotted skull laughing at them.
I'm going to smash this sneaky little bastard's skull in.
Constantine wades into the crowd and starts beating the rotlings back and forth to get Sargon, who is scurrying away. Rundi and Etrigan smash down into the street, locked in the combat. They roll along the street, tearing up the road and pavement as they do. Grundy pulls a parking meter from the ground and uses it to pummel Etrigan mercilessly. Etrigan grabs the parking meter and it melts in his hand. He headbutts the zombie and then jumps into the air and begins to stomp him down the street. The pavement beneath them gives way and they fall down into the sewers where they continue their battle. Boston watches the chaos playing out in front of him. Zatanna fends off several rotted and energy bolts, but it's clear she's weakened. Etrigan smashes up through the ground and into the street, followed by Grundy. The zombie lifts Etrigan over his head, performs a brutal backbreaker, and throws him clean through the side of the building. Pulled a Bane over Batman. He then turns his attention toward Constantine. The magician has Sargon by his arm and swings him above his head.
Gotcha, you dirty little scrote!
Grundy!
Before Constantine can smash Sargon's skull into the concrete, he is grabbed by Grundy, who lifts him up above his head. Zatanna, still holding off a group of rotlings, sees Constantine's predicament. She looks to the power cables above Grundy and snaps her fingers.
Bra uyoy in ni sell back!
The power cables detach themselves and wrap all around Grundy's forearms. The cables grow taut and begin to pull the zombie's arms apart. Grundy roars as he struggles against the cables. Etrigan appears behind Grundy and lands a crushing blow, which throws the zombie forward and causing it to drop Constantine. The demon catches the magician by the back of his shirt before he can hit the concrete.
Those who fight and run away live to fight another day. Another day to make you pay.
Great idea. See?
Zatanna is pushing the horde back as best she can, but she's being overwhelmed. Etrigan releases Constantine and the magician rushes to Zatanna's side, helps her force the rotlings back. Grundy returns and barrels through the horde, tossing them aside and crushing them underfoot. Before he can get to Zatanna, Constantine blocks his way. He holds the spear outstretched across his chest. The bright energy it emits momentarily blinding the giant zombie. Grundy covers his eyes with one hand as he swings downward with the other across the spear staff, snapping it in half. Constantine looks at the broken pieces in each hand.
Oh, that can't be good.
Grundy brings his fist down toward the magician, who is pulled out of harm's way in the nick of time by Zatanna. He drops the pieces of the spear as he staggers backward. Sargon spies the spear head on the ground and scurries toward it.
We could use an exit, see?
Sorry. I'm too weak. We could end up anywhere.
Let me worry about that.
Etrigan fights back against the horde, but is being swarmed.
Now, Z!
Zatanna stretches out her hand.
La trap, Nepo!
A swirling blue vortex opens before her. Boston materializes beside Constantine.
Where are we going?
I'll tell you when we get there. Etrigan!
The demon throws out the rotlings and runs toward the vortex. He jumps inside, followed by Boston, then Zatanna. Constantine points at Sargon.
I'll have you, mate. Just you wait.
He jumps into the portal. It sputters and closes.
Exterior swamp, Louisiana continuous. The sounds of the swamp frogs, insects fill the air. The night is broken by the vortex, in order of which they entered our hero's exit, falling down into the swamp water. The portal closes. Etrigan roars and stomps through the swamp toward Constantine.
Betrayer.
Shit.
Constantine walks backward away from the demon who slowly stalks him.
You will curse the day that I have risen for the years that you kept me imprisoned.
His body glows as he's about to breathe fire on Constantine.
Xanadu.
The demon stops and turns around towards Zatanna.
My lady.
She needs your help, Etrigan.
She betrayed me.
Contained. To be fair, she never did say which one of you she didn't like. Just that one had to go.
Etrigan, you can help us find Xanadu. You can help us find Xanadu. That's what you want, right?
Etrigan is silent for a moment before growling again. He staggers around in the mud, holding his head in his hands as if he's fighting against himself.
No, 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 no!
He writhes and roars as he slowly turns back into the form of Jason Sloan. He drops to his knees, exhausted.
Where are we now?
Somewhere safe. Maybe.
I don't know where to end up.
Synchronicity wave traveling.
Huh?
Don't question it. You okay?
Yeah. Sorry about your house.
Constantine sees the key around her neck.
Not the first time I lost a home.
She covers that key.
What now?
It's time to meet the swamp thing.
He walks off through the swamp. The others follow. Cut to interior Morrow Palace Rot World. The Marrow Palace is fashioned after an ancient castle, but made of bones, animal and human, stacked upon each other and held together by strips of dried flesh. I would love to have seen that set. Sargon scuttles along the floor, which is made of skulls, arranged in the manner of a cobbled street. As he moves, strips of rotting flesh and bones gather themselves to him as he forms into the shape of a man. When he is fully formed, he comes to heel in front of a throne of bones. Sitting atop the throne is the figure wrapped in a shawl of rotted flesh. At the foot of his throne kneel both Zatara and Xanadu. Bound by bony chains, both are slowly being affected by the rot.
Master.
Empty-handed, I see.
There are complications.
There always are. No matter. My power still grows.
What is your bidding, Master?
The figure rises up on his throne. His shadow falls over Sargon.
They will no doubt seek out the green. I think it's time to visit old friends.
Bravo. Cut two. Exterior swamp, Louisiana, dawn. The morning sun begins to rise above Louisiana. Boston floats beside Constantine, who trudges through the murky swamp water, followed by Satana and Jason.
Where are we?
The swamp.
I had noticed.
Swamps are the realm of the green.
What's the green?
Life. There are three major powers on this planet, the green, the red, and the rot. Green feeds the red, red feeds the rot, and the green would rise again. Everything in balance, what it used to be.
What happened?
We did. We destroyed the green for our cities and eat the red till there's nothing left. We feed the rot too much.
Yikes.
The rot's corruption was out of control. But the green, the red had a plan. Avatars of their power to set things right.
Did it?
Kinda. They hold back the tide just as long as humans exist. The end is inevitable.
Doesn't build confidence.
Not a lot to be confident in.
Boston floats back towards Atana.
He really knows how to boost morale.
He had a lot of faith in the worlds. Once upon a time.
For what's worth, he still cares about you.
How do you know that?
Think you skipped a line.
Oh, wait. Oh, he still left.
In his defense, I don't think that was his idea.
How do you know that?
I was in his head.
Who are you?
Right. It's not a lot of bad stuff, but a little bit of the good, too. Makes things tough, but I know John wants to help. Give him a chance. He'll do right.
Maybe.
The only good John Constantine has ever done is for himself.
Hey, man. Private conversation.
Then don't talk so loud.
Got a point.
You heard us?
I have ears, don't I? We're here.
The others all catch up with him. They look around expecting something other than just swamp. But it's more swamp, with no discernible structures.
Wow, a swamp. Just brought a camera.
Shut up.
He rolls up his sleeves and buries his hands into the swamp waters, then pulls up two thick roots of some unseen plant. He wraps them around his forearms.
Terra terra aqua et pulverum tumna sanctum et carufa.
He repeats this chant over and over again until a giant structure, a swamp cathedral, rises from the swamp waters. And go on the cathedral. It is as big as St. Patrick's, but made of vines and mud and other forms of plant life. This set would have been so cool. Constantine lets go of the roots and drops to his knees, exhausted. A doorway like a giant mouth opens.
If that isn't an invitation, I don't know what it is. Time to meet Mr. Holland.
He shoves his hand in his pockets and trudges forward the doorway. The others follow, cautiously. Boston tries to come with them, but can't. He keeps trying, but is blocked by some unseen barrier.
Hey!
Owe me the living from here. Sit tight, won't be a minute.
They continue on leaving the ghost alone. Interior swamp cathedral continuous. Inside, it is dark and cavernous. Moisture fills the air and the heat causes the group to sweat.
Use a little light, Z.
Etienne Mouly!
She snaps her fingers and her body is engulfed in flames, which illuminate the inside of the cathedral. We see that the inside is a huge tunnel which descends deeper into earth.
Nice one.
Constantine walks further down the tunnel. The others follow. Flowers bloom from the vines, which creep up down and down the walls. Each flower looks like a yellow eye, which follows Constantine and company as they walk past. After a while, they find themselves in a huge cavern. The light from Zatanna reveals the walls are covered in colorful plants of various kinds. Vines move around their feet like snakes. Water drips from above, and the eyes watch them from every corner of the room.
Less of the theatrics, Alec. We wouldn't have gotten down here if you didn't want us to.
Everybody turns as a throne erupts in the middle of the room. Sitting on the throne is a mass plant life sewn into the shape of a man standing at least 7 feet tall. This is Alec Holland, Avatar of the Green, the Swamp Thing. What do you want, John?
I'm here because you've been sitting on your ass while the competition is breaking all the rules.
Holland turns his gaze toward Constantine. His eyes are ember and sees to the lid from within. He looks weary. I asked you what you wanted, not why you were here.
Just tell me what's going on. The cryptic shite gets old, Alec.
Holland rises from his throne and stomps toward Constantine.
All in your own time, no rush.
Holland walks right past him and to Zatanna. He towers over the young magician. He smiles at her. Despite his strange form, his features are strangely human and warm. He stands there for a moment, just smiling. There is a moment of awkward silence.
Hello?
You have your mother's eyes.
I was talking to you, Alec.
But you say nothing.
Used to be a lot more coherent back in the day.
You used to be worth my attention.
Preoccupied with mud and dirt? More important to you than people these days, eh?
No, but more worthy than you. You want something for me, or else you wouldn't be here.
I'm calling in a debt. You weren't so dismissive when you needed me to do your dirty work. No wonder you and her dad got on so well.
I remember the old favors.
Of course you do, even if you forgot the loyalty.
Santana steps toward them.
We need your help. The rot is infecting everything, but you know that, don't you?
Holland doesn't answer.
We're asking that you help us, like you helped my father.
Things have changed. The old powers are not as they used to be.
Yeah, they're hiding in holes in the ground.
The bottom of a bottle is no better.
Maybe a little liquid courage would help you crawl from the depths. Never figured you for a coward, Alec.
Holland steps toward Constantine. Zatanna puts her hand on his arm.
Please, we need to know why this is happening.
Holland gazes angrily at Constantine.
Can you help us?
Of course he can. He's the great and powerful Swamp Thing.
Holland turns his gaze back to Zatanna. His smile returns.
The magician and the demon must leave.
Hang on.
Do as he says.
Get out of it.
Jason does as Holland says. Constantine lingers for a moment before lighting up a cigarette and reluctantly following, muttering under his breath. A moment later, the sound of someone falling roughly can be heard.
Bollocks!
A seat grows from the floor beside Holland's throne. He leads her over and they both sit down.
Your father was a dear friend. He spoke of you frequently. I have a daughter, too. Like your father, I wish for her to not be part of our world. We were united in our failure, it seems. He takes Satana's hand in hers.
I have no idea what I'm up against or how to stop it.
What did your father tell you?
That you hit something, powerful, and the rot wants it.
Zatanna touches the key hanging from her neck.
An ancient magic. Your father knew it was too dangerous for this world.
He told me that John would know where to find it and that it's just as dangerous as the rot.
Yes, that's why he hid it, where no one could find it, not even him.
Zatanna stands and holds her hand in her head in her hands.
My dad didn't tell me everything. I don't know if his faith in any of us.
He has great faith, but also great fear. He doesn't want to risk you making our mistakes.
Do you expect me to fix them? What about John?
He was cast out for a reason. He's weak. He always has been, perhaps always will be. You will need him. but do not put any faith in him.
You want me to use him?
There are no easy answers. I don't know how this will end. Only like all things, it must. Hawen looks around the cathedral and breathes in deeply. The walls seem to breathe with him. Zatanna looks into Hawen's eyes and takes his hand.
My father said he heard a voice, that it knew him.
The avatar of the rot.
What does it want?
To consume. Nothing more, nothing less.
There must be a way to stop it.
It can be defeated.
How?
Find the avatar and destroy it.
Where do I find it?
The rot world.
The rot world? That's a myth.
So am I.
How do I even get there?
Constantine knows the way. Titania grips his arm.
Come with us. We can't do this alone.
I will help you in my way. I will speak to the green, but the concerns of man are no longer my domain. This burden falls to you. I'm sorry, Zatanna Satara. Exterior swamp, Louisiana, continuous. Constantine leans against the cathedral, smoking. Boston looks at the giant structure in awe. Jason paces back and forth in the distance.
Hawen's gonna notice it.
Be noticeable.
We're in the middle of nowhere. I doubt a family of swamp enthusiasts are gonna appear on the horizon. Mom? Dad? Two ugly bloody kids.
Stuck in a swamp with two Englishmen. One is an asshole who never has less left in him than my corpse. Having fun, Jason?
Jason doesn't respond.
Glad you have you on the team. Gotta be honest, Z's the only cool person you know.
I prefer if you didn't call us Z. That was our thing.
When you were a thing, but you're not anymore.
I think she prefers our men to be a little bit more tangible.
How'd you get her anyway? Hypnotism?
Magnetism.
Sure, she goes for the hopeless, I guess.
Can't get any more hopeless than dead. See why she likes you.
Tana emerges from the cathedral.
So, what did Captain Fertilizer tell you?
Tana doesn't answer that.
Well?
She walks past him.
Z.
Tell me about Rotworld.
Oh, we're not going to Rotworld.
I am.
Only the dead go there.
I've never been.
Figure a speech for dramatic effect. I wouldn't put much faith in whatever he told you in there. I'm not taking you to Rotworld.
Didn't ask you to take me, just to tell me about it. I'm pretty sure I can find it myself.
Not without me. You can't work the house like I can.
Jason is shaken out of his indifference at the mention of the house.
The house? You have the key to the House of Mystery?
I wouldn't get your hopes up. Z is under strict orders not to part with it. The house can take you to Rotworld, but not without me.
Behind them, the cathedral sinks back into the... Everybody except Constantine watches it as it disappears.
This is a chance for you to do the right thing.
That's your old man's voice I'm hearing. And no disrespect, but I don't take orders from him anymore. The right thing to do would be to give me the key.
Santa pulls the chain from her neck and holds the key out into the open.
That's the one.
That's the key?
The key to the House of Mystery.
And that is?
Mystery.
Well, shit. The penny drops. Everything makes sense now.
This is as close as you're getting to it, John. And you can drop the cocky Brit swagger. I can't see, Starbuck. You don't fool me. You are as scared as me, and if you don't help me do what I need to do, so help me, I'll let you rot.
Stop making the same mistakes as the old guard. You're better than that.
I'm going to try to be.
Damn it, just give it to me.
Satana raises an eyebrow.
Take it.
Constantine stands silent for a moment, thinking of what to do.
Well, that'd happen sometime. On the legal!
Two vines erupt from the swamp and wrap around Satana's arms, binding her.
Ha!
He dashes off.
Etranichi!
The vines burn away. She spins around after the fleeing musician.
Yes, a scoff!
Constantine stops in his tracks.
Frogs.
Suddenly a flood of 1,000 frogs slam into Constantine and he is washed away. Satana brushes the cinders of the vines up of her sleeves and casually walks toward the fallen magician.
Can we be stopping this?
I'm okay with this.
Constantine stands up, covered in swamp slime and frogs, holding the key in his hand.
Yek ot im.
The key starts to be pulled back toward her. With great effort, Constantine holds it onto it. He's pulled forward to his knees, looks around with his free hand, grabs a frog from the swamp, and he holds it up.
Elytrius!
The frog crackles with blue electricity and vibrates. Constantine smiles as he drops it down into the swamp water. The frog explodes upon hitting the water, and a wave of electricity hits Satana. She is thrown backward into the swamp.
Oof.
Jason is hit by the wave and sent flying backwards.
Oh no, Jason.
Constantine stands, regards the key in his palm.
Sorry to do this to you, Z, but these rules are just going to get us all killed. Come on, I'm not going to spend all night in a bloody swamp.
What about him?
What about him? We have what we need now. You can be mad at me all you want, Z.
A blue light illuminates Constantine from behind.
Z?
He turns slowly to see Satana erupt from the swamp. She hovers high above him, angry and powerful. Her entire body crackles with magical energy.
Bollocks.
Tatibel!
Constantine is pulled from the ground and levitates into the air, paralyzed. He comes to a half-floating before Satana.
I'm sorry.
Ignelis Luf.
Constantine's mouth disappears, but from his face like the Matrix.
Did you really think your gutter magic could defeat me? I am Satana, daughter of Zatara. You, Rajan Constantine, do you understand?
Constantine nods frantically. Satana reaches out her hand and takes the key from Constantine's hand. He then looks at him with disappointment. She then looks at him.
Oi era desilir.
She snaps her fingers and Constantine's mouth returns and he drops him down to the swamp. She slowly returns to the ground in front of Constantine, who sits up in the swamp water. He rubs his mouth as he looks up at her.
Yeah, Z. I understand.
She walks past him. Jason follows her as Boston floats beside his defeated friend.
Smooth.
Cut to interior realm of the green. The realm of the green is a vast, thick rainforest teeming with life. The sky, which is only glimpsed through the thick canopy, is a golden horizon. In the center of the forest, there is a shimmering blue pool. Slowly, Holland rises from it and walks through the forest until he comes to a large clearing. In the center of the clearing stands a towering spiral of green. This is Yggdrasil, the first tree. Its booming voice echoes through the forest.
Avatar, why have you come here?
I seek the wisdom of the green. I wish to speak to the parliament of the trees.
After a moment, two other figures emerge from the forest and surround the swamp thing. These are the other members of the Trinity, of the Parliament of Trees, the Bog Venus, a female-shaped mass of plant life, and the Eum, a trilobite creature made of weeds.
Speak, Avatar!
The rod is broken, the truce. Its agents are spreading their corruption, threatening both the green and the red.
We know.
You know, yet you do nothing while my world decays. What is the meaning of this?
Rebirth.
What could be born of this corruption?
A new balance. Mankind has spread too far and too many.
This is not the way of the green.
Do not stand in the way of the rebirth.
The balance must be restored, and for what mankind must come to an end.
The Swamp Thing's eyes dim, and he lowers his head in contemplation. Exterior Main Street, Louisiana Township Day. A school bus full of children aged from between 8 and 12 drives down the main street past a football stadium, which crowds of supporters float into. My guess is to go see the Saints. We follow the bus as it comes to a halt in the parking lot outside Bizette's, which is a busy roadside diner full of customers. Constantine sits on the curb outside smoking another cigarette. The bus driver, a large burly man, opens the door, and the teacher, a woman in her 30s, leads the children off a single file and into the diner. Inside the diner, the children march past Satana and Jason, who sit in the booth while other customers stare suspiciously at them. Boston sits beside Satana. Satana stares out at the window at Constantine until her attention turns to Jason, who's looking at a young couple who are smiling and laughing.
We'll find her, Jason.
Jason turns his gaze to Satana.
I'm not sure she'd want me to find her.
I don't know why John would do that to you.
He couldn't have done it unless Nimue allowed him to. I hate him for it, but I don't blame him for it. For 1500 years, I've been cursed with Etrigan. He's a bloodthirsty monster. We're different in every way except one. We both loved Nimue. Love is a powerful thing, and a jealous demon is not easily chained. I lost control.
Demon control?
For now. But I won't free the beast again if I can help it.
Good idea. So what's next?
The only thing I know for sure is that I have to keep the key safe.
Have you ever been there? To the house?
She shakes her head. No.
You?
And Jason shakes his head as well.
Then who?
Anna looks out at Constantine, who's still sitting on the curb, showing some of the children a card trick.
I don't remember him ever mentioning a mystery house.
The Rotwet's what's in there, and only he knows how to get it. Or what it even is.
He'd only use the house as a means to save himself. He doesn't care about anyone else.
He used to.
So we do what he says? Go to the house and lay low?
Well, the world rots away?
We could bring people we care about. Keep them safe, at least. It's an idea.
We don't need an idea. We need a plan.
Plans are what you make before things go to shit. Or so I'm told.
Jason stands up.
I wouldn't let a backstabbing drunk like John Constantine stop me from saving Nimue. He must learn to listen, or I will teach him to understand.
Jason leaves the table.
Everyone's an asshole except me and you.
Satana watches as Jason awkwardly navigates the crowd, obviously irritated.
I think you're right. So, I gotta say, you're very happy-go-lucky for someone who is, I was gonna say a ghost.
It ain't my ideal situation, but you just gotta put it in hand you're dealt, right?
I guess. How do you deal with it?
Being dead or only having John to talk to?
Which is worse?
Depends on how much he's had to drink. Sure, it may not have worked out the way he planned, but the reason I'm here is because he wanted to do right by me. What a loop, he gets points for trying.
I like that.
He's not a bad guy. He just tries really hard to convince himself he is.
The waitress places a plate of food in front of Zatanna. She gives her an odd look, as it seems Zatanna is having a conversation with thin air.
I like you, Boston. I'm glad he brought you back.
Me too, most of the time. I get to check out on the people I left behind. The people I love. I just can't tell them that anymore.
Maybe someday you can. Maybe you'll get the chance.
Yeah.
Exterior, Bazette's Diner, Louisiana Township Continuous. Jason takes a seat on a bench beside an old man in his 30s. Jason reaches into his shirt and removes a locket from around his neck. He opens it. It's an old black and white picture of Xanadu. He looks at it with sad eyes. The old man in his 30s smiles at Jason. He knows that look.
That's your lady?
Sometimes.
She's pretty.
Thank you.
Not sure about the shit on her face, though. I ain't never seen that before.
We're not from around here.
No shit. You're here with your lady?
No, I haven't seen her in a long time.
Why don't you go see her?
It's complicated.
Being a dumbass probably is.
Jason gives the old man, Red Foreman, a what? Look. The old man smiles back.
It's complicated. It's just what some dumbasses say when they're scared of doing shit. You want to know what your problem is, Sonny?
What?
You're young.
Jason chuckles at the statement.
You get to my age, you know what time is important. Ain't worth wasting on complications. When you got a lady you care about, you do all the nonsense, you do what's right. You hear me?
I hear you.
That's old man, I don't know. Then go see your lady. But you might want me to take a shower first. Or, I'm sorry, you might want to take a shower first. You smell like swamp ass.
Thank you.
Exterior bleachers, football stadium, continuous. Dwight and Sally, husband and wife, sit together in the bleachers watching the game. Dwight shotguns a beer and struggles to keep it down.
I think you had enough, Dwight.
You might right gotta hose down the walls.
What? More than two shakes.
Don't deny me my pleasure, woman.
What?
Pleasure, woman. Don't deny me my pleasure, woman.
Stop saying it.
He stumbles off.
Sorry, I'm trying not to laugh right now. He stumbles off, cuts to restroom, two men at the urinals.
You hear about New Orleans?
Yeah, crazy shit. They have a whole downtown quarantined.
I heard Ebola.
My brother-in-law says they're doing the same up in Brooklyn, evacuating folk out of the city. No flights in or out.
Oh, shit.
Dwight passes them and washes his hands at the sink. He almost vomits. No, please.
Easy, easy, Dwight. Lot of hours left in the day.
The sink shakes. The sound of buzzing can be heard coming from the drain. Curiously, Dwight peers into it. Boom! A swarm of flies erupt from the sink and engulf his face. Cut to a player scores a touchdown, and Sally jumps to her feet as the crowd goes wild. Dwight, pale and in pain, staggers toward her.
Sally
runs to her husband's side. Dwight struggles forward and spews black bile all over his wife. She drops to her knees and tries to wipe the slime away. Dwight chokes and coughs more bile as two bony, deformed hands reach up from inside of, oh my God, with his mouth. They start forcing his jaw apart. His wife screams as she starts to succumb to the rot. Exterior, Bazette's Diner, Louisiana Township, continuous. Constantine is gearing up to show the enthralled kids another trick. He stops when he hears the scream and gets to his feet. He takes a few steps toward and listens as more screams emit from the stadium. Out of the top of the stadium erupts a swarm of flies.
Oh, this tune.
Inside the diner, the customers also fear the increasing screams. Confusion and terror fill the air. Satana exits the diner and walks into the street, her attention focused on the stadium and the screams. She watches in horror as hundreds of people rush out of the stadium, terrified and hysterical. They trample each other as they frantically try to escape the swarm of slavering rotlings that follow. The abominations tackle and drag their victims to the ground, spewing bile and decay all over them. Hundreds of rotlings stream out into the street.
Come on, kids, time to go.
He ushers the children off the street. Inside the diner, the customers begin to panic and rush the exits. The rotlings advance, scrambling over cars and buildings. Anyone unlucky enough to be caught in their path is attacked and infected.
Get them out of here!
She runs out into the middle of the street, readies for battle. She looks around and spies that many manhole covers around her. She snaps her fingers at each of them.
Etatuel! Etatuel!
The manholes break away from the asphalt and hover in the air.
Yorted ith tor. Ha!
The manholes spin through the air and toward the horde and slice through them, decapitating them and spilling maggots and roaches all over the ground. She watches her hands, she waves her hands and guides the manholes through the horde, thinning their numbers as much as she can. Her efforts are futile, and the swarm seems to grow larger as it advances. Her attention is turned to the open manholes. The sound of growling and hissing can be heard. Suddenly, swarms of rats erupt from the depth and explode once they hit the surface, revealing smaller rotlings which skitter along the street. They launch themselves at her.
Imoseb im glehis delihis.
One of the manholes flies through the air and affixes itself to her forearm. It acts as a shield against the tiny, throughout no less vicious rotlings. Constantine arrives at her side. The main body of the horde is almost upon them. A rotling breaks away from the swarm and lunges at Satana. Suddenly, a massive green and leafy limb appears and crushes the hideous creature. It is the Swamp Thing! The rotlings rush him and rip and tear at his plant-like frame. He smashes them to the ground and crushes them underfoot.
You must run, Satana.
Listen to the thing.
The Swamp Thing takes her hand in his. Hope looms in the darkest places. Satana sees that he has left a seed in her palm. It grows with the same elemental energy as his eyes. He smiles at her before turning and charging at the main body of the horde, forcing them back with his massive frame.
Come on, Z, no time to be heroes.
Satana reluctantly follows Constantine's lead. Hound furiously battles the horde, destroying as many as he can. Suddenly, the horde recedes and the rotlings back away. Hound watches this curiously.
Hello, Alec.
Hound turns toward the figure who stands behind him, the stag's skull hiding his face.
I know that voice. Arcane.
Constantine stops in his tracks when he hears the name. He recognizes it. The two elemental titans begin circling each other.
Sins of the past.
Yellow eyes glow with an eerie light beneath the stag's skull. The hideous visage of rotted flesh stretched over human bone twists itself into the rictus smile. This is Anton Arcane, the avatar of the rot. Holland notices that all around him, hiding behind buildings and scurrying over the rooftops, are hundreds of rotlings, but they keep their distance.
Cast a long shadow. All this for revenge.
Revenge! No. Destiny! The destiny you and the others denied me. And for that, I have come to consume you all.
There will always be rebirth, Arcane.
Rebirth! Rot spreads and festers. Soon
There will be no soil to see, no flowers to bloom. I will poison your rivers, your fields, your precious flesh. There will be no rebirth. My only regret will be that you will not be there to see my victory, old friend. But I will bless you with.
Arcane rises up and throws of his fleshy cape. His body is a horrific amalgam of abomination and pestilence. He has a gigantic centipede body as population with long jagged spider legs erupting from his back, each tipped at the head of a razor sharp claws. His remaining human torso is withered and decayed. Oh my God, this would have been so cool. His corruption stands in stark contrast to the green and fertile texture of Holland's own frame.
My majesty.
Arcane charges at Holland, who meets him with a blow across the face. This doesn't faze the Rotlord, who wraps his centipede tail around the Swamp Thing's torso. He swings Holland into the side of the building, demolishing it entirely. Holland lands on his back, and before he can get to his feet, Arcane pounces on him. The Swamp Thing kicks him back with both legs, sending him crashing into a building clear across the main street. Constantine and Zatanna flee through the chaos as townspeople run for their lives. They come to a halt when the pavement in front of them begins to crack and break away as something large forces its way to the surface. The ground shatters and explodes, and Solomon Grundy arises. The zombie stomps toward Constantine and Zatanna.
Solomon Grundy.
Already heard it, mate. Now for my next trick.
He starts to cut the deck and toss one card after another at Grundy. They become razor sharp in midair and cut into his dead flesh. It seems to cause him no discomfort.
That isn't working.
Wait for it. Abracadabra.
You gotta be kidding me. Boom! Each card erupts in an explosion of golden flame, engulfing the zombie. Constantine's smile is short-lived. The smoke clears and the zombie is still standing.
Born on Monday.
Oh, shit.
Boston hovers through the destruction and spies the school bus at the children arrived in. The bus driver is panicking and attempting to leave without his passengers. Really? He looks back over his shoulder and sees Grundy chasing Constantine and Zatanna being pursued by Grundy. Then back to the frantic bus driver. Constantine and Zatanna flee through the diner, followed by Grundy, who destroys the entire exterior and interior as he follows. Constantine zigzags through the diner interior until he notices a small boy cowering underneath one of the tables, hiding from a slavering rotling, which is stalking him.
Bollocks.
He turns on his heels and rushes to the child's aid. He takes out a Zippo lighter and sparks it up. The flame jumps from the lighter to his fist and punches the rotling, immolating it. It scrambles away in a ball of flame. Constantine snatches the boy up. Grundy attacks, bringing his fist down to crush Constantine, who shields the boy behind him.
Ego got vos!
The magician raises his hand and a series of glowing symbols appear and spin around Grundy, trapping him in place with his fingers inches from Constantine's neck. The boy runs to Zatanna's side and wraps his hands around her waist, terrified. Constantine struggles against the zombie's immense strength as Grundy's fingers edge closer and closer to his throat.
Grundy, get the blood out of here!
The boy pulls in Zatanna's hand as he watches Constantine drop to one knee as he struggles to contain Grundy.
Tatibal!
Grundy!
Zatanna jumps onto the diner counter and slides along on her knees.
Tatibal!
All around, knives, forks, and other cutlery levitate into the air. She snaps her fingers, and all at once, the knives and forks bury themselves into Grundy's hide. They zigzag back and forth through his body. Enraged, the zombie disregards Constantine, charges toward her. She jumps aside just in time as he obliterates the counter and kitchen. Zatanna Constantine and the boy flee the diner. Constantine stops and turns around.
It helped me!
The diner implodes around Grundy and condenses into a ball of wood, metal, and brick, crushing the zombie.
That'll do it, Z.
Grundy erupts from the crushed diner. He's damaged, cutlery, and debris embedded in his skin and chunks of his flesh missing, but he's still coming.
Where they dig this prick up?
He looks all around for an exit strategy. Further down the street, Holland and Arcane are locked in battle. Arcane has Holland pinned to the ground, his spider legs piercing the Swamp Thing's body and impaling him to the asphalt.
You hurt me, Alec. You and the other stole what was rightfully mine.
You were insane.
Holland digs his fist into the ground beneath him. Dozens of green vines erupt from the street and wrap themselves around Arcane, pulling him away.
Perhaps I was.
He breaks free of the vines and fires a concussive blast of dark energy from his fist into Holland, sending him flying backward and burning away a layer of his body.
But I see clearly now I was not worthy of the power. I needed something more.
Holland stretches out his hand toward a nearby electricity pole. Vines erupt from his palm and wrap around it. He pulls it from the concrete and wields it like a baseball bat. God, yes. He swings it and cracks it across Arcane's head, shattering his crown.
Or something less.
Holland tries to skewer Arcane with the pole, but the Lord of Rot wraps his tail around the Swamp Thing's forearm and rips the entire arm from his body.
I gave myself to the Rot, and return it made me good!
Constantine holding the boy in his arms and Zatanna dash down the main street. They see Arcane attack Holland again.
Time to ring the bell, Alec!
We have to help him!
Barely help ourselves, Z.
Constantine looks around at the chaos. Rotlings are attacking and affecting everyone in the town. People scream at Rotlings, rip their way out of their bodies. Jason is fighting his way through a horde of Rotlings and are dragging the old man away. They spew acidic bile into him and he starts to succumb. Despite Jason's efforts, the old man is doomed. Out of nowhere, the school bus full of screaming children screeches down the street. It stops beside Constantine and Zatanna. The doors open and the bus driver smiles at them. Thank goodness.
I had to circle around.
Austin?
In the flesh.
Yeah, Boston. Constantine ushers the boy onto the bus before turning around and calling to Jason.
Jason, it's kicking out time. Let's go.
Jason dispatches more Rotlings before taking one last look at the unfortunate old man who is more pool of blood slime than man now, then reluctantly flees. Zatanna jumps on board the bus, followed by Constantine. Out of nowhere, Grundy attacks and starts to rip chunk of the bus away to get his prey. The children all scream in terror. Jason watches as Grundy relentlessly attacks the bus. Grundy smashes his hand through the window and claws at Zatanna. He almost has her when he is struck from the side by Etrigan. Oh my God, this is so great. The zombie staggers backward a few feet before steadying himself. The demon roars and breathes a blast of hellfire at Grundy, totally emulating him. The monster, although on fire, still presses forward.
Hit the gas!
Boston slash bus driver hits the accelerator and the bus speeds off. Etrigan digs his claws into the side of the bus and escapes Grundy's clutches. Howan watches their escape and smiles.
No matter. My power grows all the same.
He plunges his fist deep into Howan's chest and twists.
Goodbye, my old friend.
He pulls his fist from Holland's chest, ripping it open. In his hand, he holds the Swamp Thing, still beating green heart. Holland falls to his knees, and the horde of Rotlings swarm over him, tearing him to pieces. Arcane notices that the heart in his hand is beginning to glow, as are Holland's eyes. The Swamp Thing smiles one last time as his heart and body explode in a powerful green energy, engulfing the entire township, destroying the Rotlings. On the bus, Constantine watches as the township is completely consumed by Holland's life energy.
Cheers, Alec.
Oh, wow. He slumps back into a seat and the bus continues on. Cut to interior/exterior school bus moving. Night. Boston/bus driver steers the bus while Etrigan sits behind him. Behind them are rows of wide-eyed children in shock at the giant demon in front of them. Their silence a stark contrast to their behavior in the diner.
Hey, anyone let Jason take over the show?
I will not become the man you seek, for Jason Blood is soft and weak.
Beautiful. You're traumatizing the kids.
Etrigan looks at the children and grunts. They collectively flinch in their seats. At the back of the bus, Constantine and Zatanna sit across from each other. Constantine holds a Superman Funko in his hand. Really? He studies the collectible.
Never understood the appeal myself.
Kids love them.
Not talking about the toys, Z. Heroes.
It's not too hard to grasp. Helping people, doing the right thing no matter what.
Been there, done that, didn't take. No such thing as heroes, love. No good guys, no bad guys. Just us. Just people.
Dad didn't think that way.
He wouldn't tell if he had. He wouldn't tell if he did, Z.
He told me once, never let what you're afraid of becoming destroy what you're meant to be.
He told you that too. Almost pissed myself laughing when he pulled that on me. Here's something else, your old man.
He said the same about you.
I'm sure he said a lot worse.
Yeah, once or twice. He didn't hate you.
Didn't like me much either. But then again, I've never met anyone who did, living anyway. Except you. Look how that turned out.
On your best days, you are an asshole. You don't make it easy. But he still cared about you, John.
Cared. He ever tell you where he found me?
No.
He should have. It's a belter of a story. Long time ago, doesn't feel like it sometimes. There was a little girl named Astra.
Oh boy. Cut to interior classroom. Astra, a pretty little girl of about 10 years old, sits in a classroom full of other students who yell and play all around her. She sits at her desk scribbling in a notepad.
Astra knew magic. All children do. We just forget.
Angle on. Notepad. Astra has drawn many strange and frightening occult symbols, all centered around a crudely drawn shape of a monster. Cut to interior bedroom. Astra sits on her bed, holding chest tight, crying. Her bedroom door closes.
Someone was hurting her, and the poor little thing didn't want to be hurt anymore.
Cut to later. Astra, still crying, frantically draws the occult symbols from her notepad onto her bedroom floor in chalk.
So, she conjured her own monster to save her.
A shadow of a horrific monster rises above Astra and looks up with a mix of awe and terror. Cut to interior living room. The living room is in complete disarray. A man, Astra's father, lies dead on the floor, his face twisted into the final look of terror as his body was ripped to pieces. Astra is curled up in the corner crying as the monster's shadow falls over her again.
But monsters don't want to save little girls.
Cut to interior/exterior. School bus moving continuous.
But I thought I could. It's a cocky little bastard back then. But I could do anything. So I cast a spell and called a monster of my own.
Cut to interior club basement. Constantine, younger and dressed like a punk rocker with the key to the house hanging around his neck, chants in front of a magic circle with terrified Astra clinging to his side. He is joined in this endeavor by his mucous membrane bandmates. Love that I got to say that again. A demon emerges from the center of the circle. Constantine, Astra, and the others look on in awe at the battle between demons happening off screen, which is told through the shadows of the wall behind them. Interior school bus continuous. Constantine, eyes filled with regret, looks at his reflection in the window.
It worked. Took a monster away. more than the price of magic. Someone has to pay.
Cut to interior club basement. Astra, her little body clenched in the monstrous hand of the demon, is dragged away to hell. Constantine, weak and covered in his own blood and the blood of his friends, called after and unable to save her from her fate.
And that someone was Astra.
The portal to hell closes and Constantine is curled up in the fetal position, crying and screaming, pushed to the edge of insanity. Cut to interior, exterior, school bus moving, continuous. Constantine swifts around uncomfortably, the memories affecting him.
Dragged to hell because I thought I could be a hero. A little crazy after that.
Cut to interior, cell, Ravenscar Asylum. Constantine, drugged and groggy, is curled up in the corner of the cell. Zatara, young and strong, Xanadu, and a tall, cruel-looking man stand over him as he cowers. Huntoon is also present.
When your old man found me, I was rotting away in an insane asylum. He offered me a chance at redemption.
Zatara reaches out his hand to Constantine. Constantine, unsure at first, takes the magician's hand.
And I took it.
Interior slash exterior school bus moving continuous.
Your father saw me for what I was. A bad guy he could use. And then one day he didn't need me anymore. He never cared about me.
I did. And you left me behind without a word.
I did you a favor.
Maybe you did, but you deserved a choice. You hurt me.
Yeah, I know. Just who I am, Z. I hurt people. Especially if they care about me. Your father knew it. Now so do you.
Constantine's shoulders slump and he lowers his gaze. This confession has defeated him. His confidence and cockiness has finally been drained. After a moment, Satana reaches into her pocket and takes out the key.
I've always known who you are. You're John Constantine.
She offers him the key. Constantine contemplates it for a moment.
Let's see what that means.
Constantine takes the key. Exterior, old townhouse road, are continuous. The lonely stretch of road is home to single Civil War era townhouse. It's in a serious state of disrepair and completely abandoned. The school bus comes to a halt. Everyone but the children disembark. Constantine walks toward the house.
This'll do, I suppose.
That's it? That's the house mystery?
Constantine walks up to the front door and inserts the key into the lock. He turns it and it makes a loud click. He slowly pushes the door open, revealing a bright interior which emits a bright light. Constantine gestures to Zatanna.
After you.
Zatanna cautiously steps inside. Etrigan, unsure, turns to Constantine.
If this is some magician's trick, I'll break your bones and rip off your...
Not a trick. Not a trick. You want to find your girlfriend, don't you?
Dick.
Etrigan's eyes dart back and forth between the doorway and the magician for a moment until... He relents and walks into the house.
You can't take him with us.
Boston slash bus driver remembers that he's possessing the bus driver.
Right.
He faces out of the bus driver, who stands motionless with a vacant look in his eyes. Boston enters the house. Constantine follows, closing the door behind him. After a moment, the bus driver falls to the ground. Interior foyer, the house of mystery, continuous. Zatanna walks slowly into the foyer of the house. It's fashioned after the manner of townhouses of Victorian-era Britain, grandiose and opulent, but one step removed from our reality. The colors are indifferent, more vibrant. The furniture is in an odd style, familiar yet exaggerated. The floors are shimmering marble. At either side of the main doors are two sets of medieval knight's armor who has Broad's Word impaled in its chest. Broad's Word. Constantine stands behind her and lights up a cigarette.
You imagined.
I don't know what I imagined.
John?
Constantine looks to the right. Boston stands in shock, looking at his very real hands with his very real eyes. The house has given him back his body. He's alive and completely naked. Constantine looks at him for a moment before punching him in the mouth.
Ow!
Everything.
Boston touches his bloody lip, looks at the blood on his fingertips, and starts to laugh.
I'm alive, John. I'm alive.
Constantine walks over to a nearby table, which has a bottle of whiskey and glass on it, as if waiting for him. He pours himself a drink.
Maybe. The house likes to play tricks. Sometimes it's hard to tell what's real.
My jaw feels pretty real. How?
It's the funny thing about being everywhere all at once. Anything can happen. It usually does.
None of this is fazing you?
I've seen stranger. I used to live here.
This was your house?
I won it in a card game. Might have cheated.
All of a sudden, Etrigan lets out a blood-curdling scream. Excuse me. The Demon Knight is on one knee, holding his head in his hands. Screaming in pain, he stands up and reveals that his face is warped and contorting. His whole body follows suit.
Never before have I felt such pain. What have you done to me, magician?
Etrigan is literally being torn apart from Jason. The man is violently separated from the demon's body. Jason falls to his knees, gasping for air. Satana and Boston stand in shock and awe as Etrigan rears himself to full height and lets out a thunderous roar of triumph. His pure demon form, encumbered by any traces of humanity, is larger and more bestial than before. Constantine is calm and
freedom.
You got it, Mr. Wallace. For a moment, the beast eyes the others curiously before focusing on Jason.
Blood.
Dracula. The demon attacks, rushing at Jason, who narrowly moves out of the way. The monster smashes clean through the wall behind him.
Do something.
Up to you, mate.
I just now came back to life.
Jason gets to his feet. He runs to the suit of armor and pulls the broad's word free.
That's the spirit of your team, asshole.
Jason charges the demon, swinging the sword at it. The beast catches the blade and strikes him, sending him careening back through the staircase. Satana jumps in front of the demon.
Miraster, quit Icky!
And nothing happens. Satana's shocked.
House won't let you do that, Z.
The demon charges at Satana and pounces. Boston quickly dives and pushes her out of the way. He narrowly escapes Etrigan's attack, and the beast's fist smashes through the floor they were standing on. The demon swings again. This time he punches the nearby door. It breaks into pieces, revealing a shocking truth. The house itself is flying through infinite void, a reality outside of conventional time and space. This would have been so fucking cool. The demon turns to Constantine.
Release me, magician.
You already are.
Etrigan lunges at Constantine, but before he can strike, half of a dozen chains appear and wrap themselves around his arms, legs, and across his maw. He is pulled backward toward the hole in the floor and down into the depths. Constantine watches, unfazed and disinterested. The floorboards close up, and the house quickly repairs itself and returns to how it was before it, as if nothing had happened. The demon's roar fades into the distance. Jason gets to his feet. He's surprisingly uninjured.
Spent years trying to figure out how to separate those two figures. Anyway, I don't know about you, but I can go for a shower and a bit of a kip. Bedrooms might be upstairs. If you're looking for clean clothes, looking at you, Boston, they're probably already there. Depends. And before I forget, be careful with what rooms you go into, because they might lead to another dimension full of crazy clowns or a bloke dressed up like a bat.
He leaves. Satana and Boston look around the room and then to watch each other, not quite sure what to do next. Interior hallway, house of mystery continuous. Satana, House, and Brand walk slowly through the hallway. Watson stops by a mirror and stands at his reflection. He touches his face and looks at his hands in awe. He smiles, his eyes welling up with joy.
See you soon, Don.
Jason and Zatanna slowly peer into the bedrooms. Each bedroom is a huge and luxurious, similar to those of Victorian high society. Jason steps inside one of the rooms and sees a marble bust of a man dressed like a Victorian gentleman, crossed with a knight. He walks over to the mannequin and observes the metal breastplate, which has a symbol of a demon on it. Hanging from the bust is in a scabbard of knight's sword. Beneath the sword hang two daggers. Jason runs his fingers along the blades. Interior wine cellar, house of mystery continuous. Etrigan, bound in chain, roars and struggles against his bonds. Constantine, recently bathed and wearing a bathrobe, enters the wine cellar and studies the bottles. He pays the demon no attention. Etrigan claws toward Constantine, but he can't reach him. Constantine picks up a bottle of wine. He turns and smiles at Etrigan, who is struggling to get to him, but can't.
Oh, this is why you and Xanadu never worked out.
Etrigan stops struggling. Constantine smirks and leaves.
Do better, big man.
Interior Satana's bedroom, house of mystery, continuous. Angle on bed. Laid out on the bed is a female stage magician's outfit, top hat, three-piece suit. Zatanna approaches the bed and picks the top hat up and admires it. Interior gallery, the house of mystery, later. The gallery is a large room where the walls are covered with dozens of paintings and portraits from several different eras of Earth's history. The ceiling of the gallery is a massive mural of the cosmos, which seems to be moving. The centerpiece is a giant fireplace. Constantine stands in the middle of the gallery, pouring himself a glass of wine. Zatanna enters dressed in a magician's outfit.
Looks like a Zatara. Drink?
No, thank you.
This is 2,000 years old and belongs to Merlin. Have a drink, you're dressed for it.
Feels right. I don't know why.
The house wouldn't have given it to you if it didn't.
This place is amazing.
You get used to it after a while.
I don't know why Dad hated this place.
Because he couldn't control it.
You can.
Not really. Just about being in the right place at the right time. It's the synchronicity way. The power to be right where you need to be. Some people have it, and some people it's just me.
Where did it come from?
Don't know. No one does. All I know is it's alive and it's powerful. But it'll be good to you, if you let it.
Jason enters the room. His cape flows behind him and his sword hangs from his belt. He looks like he walks straight out of a fairy tale.
How's it feel to be going solo?
Different.
Different beats demonic any day.
For centuries, I've tried to free myself of him. It was a curse that couldn't be broken. I don't understand this.
But don't try to. Just go with it. Drink.
Jason takes the glass. The sound of something slamming into the wall can be heard. They all turn to see Boston, slightly dazed, step out from behind a door frame. He's wearing a clean leotard.
Look, getting used to the whole tangible thing. That ain't right.
The dead man looks around at the formerly dead man looks around at the dozens of paintings on the walls.
Was this room here before?
Sometimes.
Have we decided what we are to do?
I think it's time you told us what you hid here, John.
Yeah, I figured you'd ask me that. Well, gather around, kids. And let me tell you about the last time the world almost ended.
The lights seem to dim and the room seems to become smaller. Constantine looks up at the moving mural of cosmos above them. The galaxies and nebula swirl and flow.
The universe is made of many dimensions. Some are heaven, some are hell, others are much, much worse. Every once in a while, something crosses over.
He gestures to the painting above the fireplace, which is now depicting Trigon. Yes! A hideous six-eyed red demon.
Your father called it Trigon. The dark god who fed on worlds. Earth's source was good and evil, friends and enemies united to send it back to where it came from.
Oh my god, I love this script. He gestures to another painting above Boston, which now depicts numerous sorcerers locked in a fierce battle with Trigon.
It had power like nothing in this universe. And would have won. But for fate himself.
Yes! The painting that has previously depicted Trigon has become a beautiful portrait of Dr. Fate, a powerful sorcerer wearing a gold metal helm. His body glows with magical energy.
Most powerful sorcerer on Earth led the charge. Oh my God. Well, never knew how close it came to ending that day. Or the price that was paid.
The others look around the gallery at the paintings, which are now all depicting moments from the battle. Fallen sorcerers lying dead, while Zatara, Syndella, Xanadu, and Fate battle Trigon. Oh my God.
Fate died saving the universe.
No!
The helm of fate no longer had a master.
Another portrait shows the helm on the ground, smoke rising from its eyes. The surviving sorcerers stand around it.
What did they do with it?
Same thing they've always done with power. Fought over it. It's a great and secret war. Anton Arcane, a powerful sorcerer obsessed with eternal life, tried to claim the helm for himself.
The others look to the main painting above the fireplace once more. It has become a portrait of Arcane, still human, tall and noble, but with a gleam of cruelty in his eyes. He was the third sorcerer recruited Constantine all those years ago.
After the war with Trigon, there were a few left who could stand against him, except Zatara. And Syndella.
Titania is clearly affected by the mention of her mother's name.
They beat him?
By using what he desired against him. Syndella used the helm of fate to defeat him, stole his power away. Should have killed him. Maybe it was mercy.
The painting has now become a landscape showing Titania's mother wearing the helm of fate, defeating Arcane, who was brought to his knees.
There was a cost.
Constantine looks up to the ceiling. The others follow his gaze. It has become a mural of Zatara holding Zendella's dead body in his arms.
The strain of using the helm killed Syndella.
Zatanna's eyes well up upon her seeing her mother in her father's arms.
The helm of fate is the most powerful weapon on the face of the earth. Your father knew what would happen if it ever fell into the wrong hands. He couldn't destroy it, he'd hide it instead. In here. A place where he knew no one would ever find it. Not even him. Then when everyone decided I couldn't be trusted not to use it, they took the key and kicked me out of the club. Worked out well for everyone.
Where is it?
Most devastating weapon in the world has ever known. Power to control the universe, the fabric of it.
There is a tense moment of buildup, a prelude to some great revelation. Constantine casually points across the room.
So there.
Everybody's eyes follow Constantine's gesture across the room toward a coat rack where the helm of fate is just hanging out in the open next to a trench coat.
Dad searched the house for years. Looking for it.
You didn't know where to look. I mean, it's exactly where I left it.
Zatanna walks over to the helm and takes it in her hands. Upon touching it, her fingers light up with magical energy. Her face is reflected in its golden surface.
I can feel it. I can feel the power. This can kill Arcane.
It's not much it can't do.
Then we use it.
What a chance.
If you have an alternative, I'm all ears.
Did you hear anything I said? I mean, we're doing okay. You have a second chance at life now. And you're no longer sharing source space with a demonic entity. I think we're all winning here.
Maybe.
Not a maybe. That power comes at a price. Your mother learned the hard way.
Don't even try to tell me about my mother.
Someone needs to.
Hey, John, chill.
It's the difference between me and your old man, Z. I'll tell you the truth. And the truth is that if you use that, you die.
Tana ponders Constantine's words.
Then I die.
I'm not going to watch that.
Satana looks into Constantine's eyes, searching for anything that will change her mind.
This is goodbye. I'll need the key.
Why? You won't be coming back.
That's the thing. I don't need to.
Constantine reaches into his pocket and removes the key.
The house can take us to other worlds. Other Earths. Places you can't even imagine, where none of this matters. It doesn't have to be this way.
You know it does. I'm not going to run away with you, John.
He absorbs what she said, and after a moment, hands her the key. She gives Constantine one last look, perhaps one of pity, then leaves the gallery.
There you go.
Suicide, Boston. We don't want to die twice.
This.
We're only human. This is all gods and monsters, and all we have is a demon in the wine cellar. We can't win this.
Are you so sure?
I've been on this path before. I know where it leads. Failure, death, and everything in between.
You want to know something? You wouldn't have to keep running from your mistakes. You just stop making.
Boston turns to follow Zatanna.
You're going to go with her?
Yeah.
You're just a man now, Boston.
Boston looks his old friend in the eyes.
And I'm going to go act like one.
He follows Zatanna. Jason walks up to Constantine and puts his hand on his shoulder.
May you live forever, John Constantine.
He leaves with the others. Zatanna stands in the foyer in front of the main doors. She smiles when she sees Boston come to her side.
You don't have to do this, Boston.
Only twice, right? What's the worst that can happen?
Jason joins them. Zatanna takes a deep breath and reaches for the door handle.
Are you sure? Are you sure where you're going?
We'll see. Please take me where I need to go.
She pulls the door open. Outside is Rotworld. Rotworld is a twisted and decayed mirror image of our world. The buildings are all destroyed and rotten. The soil is sour and poison. The sky is gray maelstrom of thunder and lightning. Sounds like the upside down. Zatanna takes a deep breath and steps outside. Boston and Jason follow. The door behind them closes. Its sound echoes through the house. That silence. Constantine stands alone in the gallery. Cut to exterior Rotworld. Zatanna, Boston, and Jason walk cautiously through the apocalyptic decay that is the Rotworld. All around them, in the buildings and structures, rotlings hiss and scurry about. They stop when they see someone standing alone in the distance. It's Sargon. He smiles as he runs his fingers across the tip of his spearhead of destiny.
My monster welcomes you to the mountain.
She looks at him in disgust.
Sargon, what have you done?
A small price to pay to the right hand of God. You'll understand that.
Debatable.
Anton, just for you to be his guest. If you follow me.
Sargon bids them to follow him. Jason tightens his grip on the hilt of his sword.
I should take his head.
Satana grabs him by the forearm.
No, we're surrounded.
Boston and Jason look around to see hundreds of pale, lifeless eyes staring back at them from the structures.
Why won't they attack?
Hannah grips the helm tight into her side.
They're afraid. Let's use that.
With Zatanna at the lead, they follow Sargon. Interior gallery, the House of Mystery. Constantine bitterly pours himself another glass of wine.
There are easier ways to kill yourself. Razor blades are cheap. Don't want to have a bridge cost you nothing. Damn it, see.
Why won't you help?
Constantine shakes his head and downs his wine.
Don't do this. Not now.
You used to help people.
Turns around slowly to see Astra standing behind him. She looks at him with wide, questioning eyes.
You're not even real. Just an illusion. This isn't fair. Stop playing tricks.
I know you're afraid.
It's not fair.
Then why won't you fight?
Constantine contemplates his answer for a moment.
Because I'll fail.
You don't know that.
I failed you. You're gone because of me. If I die, there's no way I can fix that. No way I can bring you back.
How can I come back if there's no world for me to come back to?
Constantine slumps to the floor and tosses the wine glass aside. He holds his head in his hands.
I can't do this, love. I'm a nasty piece of work. I've never been a hero.
Astra leans down to look him in the eyes. She smiles.
You were mine, John Constantine.
Constantine lowers his gaze for a beat. When he looks back up, Astra has disappeared and he's alone again. Cut to exterior Mara Palace, Rot World. Arcane's palace is fashioned after a medieval European castle. Instead of stone and mortar, it's built from bone and dried flesh. Zatanna, Boston, and Jason follow Sargon toward its coffin gates. Interior throne room, Mara Palace continuous. Zatanna and the others follow Sargon into the throne room. Arcane sits on the throne, awaiting his guests. Grundy, still damaged from before, stands at his side. Zatara and Xanadu kneel before him, their bodies even more consumed with rot since we last saw them. Sargon bows before Arcane, then turns to their guests.
Behold his majesty, the avatar of rot, the lord of corruption, the angel of decay, Anton Arcane.
Dad?
Zatanna.
Jason is enraged when he sees Xanadu. He draws his sword.
Sorry. Release her.
You've come here to make demands, Jason Blood. Xanadu's every thought is open to me. She fears you. And yet you risk your life for us?
Always.
How human.
You will free them, Arcane, or be destroyed.
You do have your mother's eyes.
You will restore balance to my world. You will never again cross over. This place will be your prison.
Prison? This is my kingdom! I was beaten, broken, humiliated. This realm is my salvation. It embraced me when your kind banished me.
You traded your humanity for petty revenge.
I did it gladly. And now the sorcerers are all gone.
The green retreats, your world falls around you, and yet you come here to make demands of a god.
Tana raises the helm up. Arcane smile disappears.
You think you can threaten me with that? You don't even know what you hold. There is a price to power. Are you willing to pay it, Zatanna Zathara?
I am.
Your mother thought the same. She was so sure she could control it. Only I have that power. Only I have been worthy. You have brought me my prize. And for that, I will reward you. You may be my concubine.
I'll pass.
Slave, then. You may wish to defy me, but here I am. The beginning and the end.
He raises his hand and the ground beneath them shakes as the Mara Palace itself raises up high into the sky and is consumed by the storm above them.
I am your god now.
Zatanna, Boston, and Jason struggle to stand as the ground cracks and uber rotlings emerge from the depths. These uberots are different than before. They are far larger and more bestial, seemingly made from the Mara Palace itself.
You should have prayed to me!
The uberots attack!
You're up, Dnaev Kareb!
She snaps her fingers and many of the lifbots burn and split in half.
Yofyawa!
She levitates off the ground and with great mental focus take off into the sky as uberots jump and try to grab her. One tackles her out of the air. The helm flies from her grasp. Boston dodges uberots and other abominations as he jumps, somersaults, and snatches the helm out of the midair and hits the ground running.
Latem to Sif.
He parkours, flips, and somersaults through the ever-changing environment, dodging fatal blows by a hair's breadth. Zatanna hits the ground and rolls with the uberot. She kicks it off of her and gets to one knee. The monster attacks again.
Wait, where are we? Leviosa. Let him sif.
Her fist transforms into solid steel and she punches clean through the uberot's face. Several uberots attack.
Let him smra.
Both her arms turn to steel and she punches her way through the horde, crushing their heads and ripping them clean in half. Nice.
Why didn't I think of this before?
She smiles and keeps fighting her way through the horde, but for everyone she destroys, two more take its place. Jason slashes through several uberots toward Xanadu. His moves are that of a grateful and highly trained swordsman, a pure warrior from a bygone era. After he dispatches his last foe, he rushes to Xanadu's side. He slices through her chains and takes her in his arms.
Jason.
I'm here, Nim.
Jason.
Rest, Nim.
Behind the reunited lovers, Zatanna fends off as many of the uberots as she can, but unbeknownst to her, the arcane himself advancing on her and seizes her by the neck, by the back of her back of the head, and lifts her off the ground. Angle on arcane's mouth behind the rows of rotted teeth is bulbous and pus-filled tongue with several smaller mouths on its rancid flesh. He holds her close to his face and the smells of his rotting flesh causes her to gag. Jason sees Zatanna has been captured.
Zatanna!
Xanadu weakly lifts her arm and points over his shoulder. Jason looks over his shoulder and sees Grundy barring down on him. He is caught totally off guard and reaches for his sword, but the zombie has the drop. Boom! The door to the House of Mystery opens behind Jason with a blinding white light. Etrigan launches himself out of the door and tackles Grundy and launches him backward through Arcane's sword, Arcane's throne, shattering it. This also frees Zatara of his bonds. Constantine steps out of the doorway, puffing on a cigarette, hair slicked back, wearing a shirt and tie in his trademark trench coat. This is the John Constantine of legend.
John!
Put it down, mate. Telling, not asking.
It's like an endgame moment. Arcane's laughs at the threat.
John Constantine! Come to fail again, I see.
No harm in trying.
I've seen Zatara's mind. I've seen you crawl and grovel, beg for him to help you free poor little Astra. You couldn't save a child then. You couldn't save your world now.
Arcane's jaw opens so wide that it unhinges itself. He's about to bite Satana's head clean off.
Okay, asshole. Make some mischief.
He pulls out two tarot cards from his pocket, holds them in his palms, and slams his hands together.
May the CMS talk.
The cards vaporize upon impact on a shockwave of energy, and that forces Arcane backwards and momentarily stuns him. Satana sees her opportunity and raises her hands to his face.
On Renfi.
Her hand catches fire and she stabs them into Arcane's eyes. He releases his grip on her and falls.
Tatirel.
She stops before she hits the floor. Constantine takes her by the hand and stands her up upright. They stare a moment. Boston, out of breath and sweating, joins them.
Really?
50-50. 60-40. All yours.
Cheers.
Sargon appears behind them and takes aim at Constantine with the spearhead.
Worthless trash.
Sargon sends a spear flying through the air towards Constantine. Boston sees the spear closing in.
Look out.
He dives in front of Constantine and the spearhead buries himself into his chest.
Boston!
Boston rolls onto his back, gripping the spearhead.
I'll have you for that.
Will you?
Constantine tosses the helm to Zatanna and rolls up his sleeves.
Well, yours, Z.
Two balls of energy materialize in his palms before expanding into glowing occult symbols. He and Sargon face off. Both men send powerful beams of energy at each other, which clash in midair. It's a magical test of strength, or Dragon Ball Z. Zatanna takes the helm and races away. She finds himself pursued by Arcane, who is even larger now, his body absorbing the world around him. Constantine and Sargon are still locked in conflict. They try to overpower each other with their mystical energies.
You are always a joke.
Constantine is being forced backward by Sargon's power. His feet dig into the poisoned soil. He's clearly no match for Sargon. Suddenly, the tip of the spearhead is forced through the back of Sargon's skull and out between his eyes. His eyes cross as he focuses on the tip. Boston stands behind him, clutching his own wound. Constantine flexes his hands and smiles.
Ipsa.
Suddenly, all Sargon's limbs are outstretched.
Est sculptor.
Sargon is ripped to pieces and scattered to the wind. The dismembered parts of Sargon's twitch and writhe on the ground.
Is he dead?
Close enough.
Zatanna is still fleeing Arcane. The dark sorcerer is manipulating the environment around her. The ground beneath her feet opens up to reveal a deep pit filled with monstrous, rotted serpents. They rise up from the depths of their long necks and snap and bite at her. She dodges like their jaws and snaps her fingers.
Like that.
The serpent's necks all become entangled with and find themselves wrapped in one another. Constantine watches Zatanna repel the serpents.
Better get back to work, mate. Let's sit this one out. Be the hero.
Boston looks at his wound. It's gushing blood.
No problem.
Constantine runs towards Zatanna. Boston stands for a moment before falling backward onto his ass. Constantine chases after Zatanna, only to be blocked by a swarm of Uberots, which emerge from the ground around him.
Genus Clamantibus.
A circle of blue fire erupts around him, forcing the Uberots back. Etrigan and Grundy are locked in battle. Grundy has the upper hand and is pummeling Etrigan mercilessly.
Solomon Grundy, Solomon Grundy, Solomon Grundy.
Anyway, he grabs Etrigan's throat and begins to slam his head down into the dirt and decay repeatedly. Etrigan's POV, he sees Jason jump through the air over Grundy's shoulder. Jason plunges the sword through Grundy's back. The zombie releases the demon and turns around to face Jason, the sword still sticking out of his back. Jason pulls the two daggers from behind his cape and readies for battle. Grundy stomps toward him. Jason's sword is pulled from the zombie's back. Grundy looks around and sees Etrigan holding the sword. The blade catches fire in the demon's hand. Grundy looks back and forth between his foes.
That's fucking sick. Demon and man side by side. Surely this will turn this battle's tide.
Oh my god, this is amazing.
It's so fucking cool. It's so fucking cool. Like, what?
Oh. They both attack the zombie. This is so badass. Grundy is surprisingly quick and blocks and parries all their attacks. Etrigan breathes fire, but Grundy simply fights through it and repeatedly punches the demon before picking him up and suplexing him into the ground. While Grundy is on his back, Jason attacks and tries to stab the zombie, but Grundy catches him by his wrists and begins to pull his arms out of their sockets. Jason screams.
Pavimento!
Oh my god! The zombie releases Jason. Behind him, weak and still suffering from the rot, is Xanadu. She struggles to keep Grundy under her control. With a great strength, the zombie stands. His necrotic flesh is torn off of him in ribbons as he fights against Xanadu's power. He reaches toward her, and with every step, even more flesh is torn away. He reaches out to grab her, but before he does, his arm is severed at the elbow by Etrigan's burning blade. Jason's attacks and slashes the back of Grundy's legs, completely severing his tendons. The zombie falls to his knees.
Now accursed and hated dead, Etrigan shall have your worthless head.
Etrigan swiftly beheads him. Grundy's head rolls along the ground, his eyes darting back and forth. He's still alive / undead. Jason catches Xanadu before she falls. Man and demon are both clearly concerned for her well-being.
Nimue, speak to me.
I can't hold on much longer, Jason. This place is poison.
Help me get her out of here. Now is the time that we must flee. But when this is over, she comes with me.
Jason slaps his hand away.
You don't love her.
Angry, Etrigan kicks Grundy's head off into the distance. Yeah, field goal. We follow the zombie's head as it flies above Zatanna, who is facing off against Arcane. The dark sorcerer manipulates the ground beneath her while firing bolts of dark energy at her. She, with great strain, deflects the bolts and dodges the sharp protrusions of the warping terrain beneath her. A sharp spike shoots up from the ground beneath her and slices her shoulder. She falls roughly. The seed Holland gave her flies from her pocket and out of her reach. Boston watches as the seed comes to a halt. Arcane sees the seed and scoffs.
Holland, there's no life here, only death.
He opens his palm and a swirling black vortex of energy appears. He hurls it at Zatanna. Zatara, almost completely consumed by the rot, appears between them and stops the energy in midair. He propels it back at Arcane. He strikes the dark sorcerer, momentarily stunning him.
God.
Run, Zatanna.
Not without you.
It is too late for me.
Arcane steadies himself and throws another ball of dark energy at Zatara. It hits its mark and vaporizes the magician.
No!
And vaporizes the magician. Boston, on his knees, clutches his still bleeding wound. He sees the Uberots are swarming Constantine. Zatanna is on her knees, crying over the death of Zatara. Arcane is closing in on the helm. They are failing. He picks the seed up from the ground. It glows when his blood touches it. Green tendrils begin to sprout.
Life. Easy come, easy go. Sorry, Don.
He plunges the seed into his wound. Almost immediately, he is taken over by a powerful elemental energy. He screams in pain as green vines erupt from his wound and begins to consume his body. He slams his palms down into the sterile, poisoned earth. Vines stream from his wound and into the ground. The ground quakes and cracks, and the swamp thing emerges, reborn. He's much larger now, with antlers protruding from his brow, massive wings spread from his shoulders. He flies into the sky, leaving Boston's body behind. The swamp thing descends from the sky and crashes into Arcane, the impact creating a massive crater and a powerful shockwave. Constantine rushes to Boston's side and lifts him to his feet and carries out of the shockwave's reach. The swamp thing and Arcane go to war with each other, their powerful elemental energies clashing violently. This is a battle between gods of nature. Green versus rot, growth versus decay, life versus death. Every time Holland lands a blow, green life, energy, and fertility spread throughout the terrain of Rot World. Each strike, the avatars land on each other, changes the surrounding landscape drastically. Arcane plunges his claws into his enemy's body while Holland returns in kind, each infecting the other with their essence. But it's clear that Arcane's power is stronger here. Holland begins to weaken, Arcane's essence consuming his body.
This is my realm, my world!
Right. Open a portal.
What?
You're too powerful here.
We can end up anywhere.
Anywhere but here.
That drop, Nero.
She snaps her fingers and a portal opens.
The heel hair guest fits.
Constantine adds his own magic to the portal and it begins to expand and expand. Arcane throws Holland aside and beelines towards Zatanna.
Come on, you big dirty wanker.
The portal has absorbed the entirety of the Morrow Palace.
Now, Z!
One Elosk, Yarud.
She snaps her fingers and the whole structure is pulled through the portal. Cut to exterior Central Park, New York City, night. It's late afternoon and the park is deserted. The city is eerily silent. Suddenly, the portal appears above the center of the park and the Morrow Palace crashes down to the earth below. Dust and debris fill the air. Zatanna staggers through the remains of the palace as the dust settles.
John, Austin, Jason.
Debris behind her begins to move. She swings around and prepares for an attack. Holland emerges from the rubble, his body torn and infected. Nearby, Jason holds Xanadu in his arms. She's unconscious, but the color has returned to her face. Etrigan is beside them, looking concerned for Xanadu. In this hand, he holds Grundy's severed head by the scalp. Nice trophy. The zombie's eyes flick back and forth. Holland, his body still infected by Arcane's essence, inhales deeply. All around, the trees wither and turn to mulch as he absorbs their energy and repels the rot. Zatanna kneels beside Jason and Xanadu.
How is she?
She's alive.
Zatanna looks around for Constantine.
John?
She spies him kneeling beside Boston, who sat against a tree. He's dying.
No.
She rushes to Boston and takes his hand in hers. Boston smiles at her softly. It's obvious he hasn't much time left.
Boston.
It's okay, John.
I never did help you, like I promised.
You did. At least this time means some. Goodbye, John.
Boston Brown smiles warmly and closes his eyes, dying for a second time.
Smooth.
Zatanna wraps her arms around Constantine. She has tears in her eyes.
Sorry.
We all lost something today, Z.
Silence. Boom! Suddenly, Arcane emerges from beneath the ruins of the Morrow Palace. Arcane Z Zatanna holding the helm. Holland and Etrigan attack Arcane. Jason picks Xanadu up and carries her to safety. Etrigan breathes a continuous stream of fire at Arcane and forces him backwards. Holland raises plant tendrils from the ground, which wrap themselves around Arcane and pull him to the ground. Arcane lets out a powerful blast of dark energy, which vaporizes the tendrils and most of the surrounding park, infecting them with rot. He fires another blast of dark energy at Etrigan, which sends him flying backward through the air. Holland attacks again, but he is overpowered. Arcane throws him through the air and clear out of the park and through the top of a nearby skyscraper. Constantine rushes to her side.
Time to go, Z.
They flee with Arcane in hot pursuit. He smashes through the trees, which slow him down. Constantine and Zatanna exit the park and find themselves on 6th Avenue. The avenue is deserted. Cars and ambulances are abandoned all down the avenue and streets. Arcane's rot has taken hold of their absence. Constantine sees a horse-drawn carriage without a driver and jumps on board.
The giant awaits.
Zatanna joins them and he snaps the reins and the horses take off running. Arcane tears off of the park and gives chase. Zatanna sees Arcane closing in on them.
Faster.
As he follows, he absorbs the surrounding area and any people unlucky enough to be still in the street into this body mass and grows larger. Constantine navigates the horses between the abandoned vehicles. Zatanna stands on top of the carriage. She snaps her fingers at parked cars along the venue. Avenue.
Rock Pilf. Edol Pixie.
The cars fly through the air and slam into Arcane, burying themselves into his body before exploding. This slows him down momentarily, but doesn't stop him. Zatanna snaps her fingers at a high fire hydrant. It bursts and Zatanna guides the water toward Arcane.
Azir!
The water freezes Arcane solid and he finally stops his pursuit. Constantine pulls on the reins and the horse come to a halt on the fringes of Times Square. There are police and military ushering terrified New Yorkers onto buses for evacuation. Holland soars through the air on his giant wings with Jason on his back. He lands near Constantine and Zatanna, cracking the concrete underfoot. Arcane's body is shattered by Etrigan, who smashes through it. Pieces scatter all along the street. Constantine and Zatanna exit the carriage and the horse gallops away into the night. They all watch the frozen pieces of Arcane begin to crack open. All of the separate pieces of the Lord of Decay grow spider-like legs and scurry to each other to begin to reform.
Bloody hell.
He cracks his knuckles and the glowing occult symbols appear around his fists. Arcane rises again. Millions of rats, cockroaches, and other vermin stream from the sewers and are absorbed into his body. He grows larger and stronger. He drives the spider legs down into the concrete and they zigzag beneath the streets and into the surrounding buildings. Streetlights sputter and go out. Times Square goes dark. Constantine Etrigan, Holland, and Jason attack Arcane with a ferocity none seen before. Each pushes themselves to the limits, but even with their combined abilities, they are severely outmatched. Every spell and attack is countered. Every limb that they sever is replaced. Nothing has a lasting effect. Their combining magic and brute strength prove futile. Arcane cannot be subdued or stopped. Arcane is drawing power from the sewers beneath him, and his rot spreads all through the surrounding area. He is consuming everything and everyone, and grows larger and larger until the city itself begins to become a part of him. New York City shakes beneath their feet. The pavement cracks and buildings begin to topple around them. The New Yorkers, cops, military run for cover as a swarm of flies engulfs Times Square. Zatanna looks on in horror, then at the helm in her hands. Arcane has defeated his foes. Holland is missing an arm and much of his face, his green blood spewing all over the concrete. Etrigan is being swarmed by rotlings. Jason is on his knees, pulling a sharp chunk of concrete from his chest plate. Blood pours from his wound. Only Constantine still stands, weak, bloodied, bruised, but still defiant.
Oh, you have in the tank, mate.
The concrete beneath Constantine's feet cracks open and tendrils of rot shoot up from the depths and wrap themselves around his body and creep into his mouth and begin to suffocate him in filth. Holland reaches out to him, but is swallowed up by a sea of deformed rats. Etrigan and Blood fight in a losing battle, back to back, against hordes of rotlings. Arcane laughs maniacally as his enemies crumble before him. He stops suddenly and looks, and a look of fear creeps across his face. Constantine looks around slowly, and he sees that what has frightened Arcane. His eyes widen in shock and concern. Zatanna is wearing the helm of fate. Volatile magical energy courses through her body and she levitates off the ground. The gravity around her is affected. Debris and rubble lift around her only to be vaporized by the energy that strikes out from her like electricity.
No, no, no! That's mine! Mine!
Arcane lashes out at Zatanna, his fear replaced by irrational rage. Zatanna simply raises her hand and releases a powerful beam of energy at Arcane. The avatar of the rot attempts to counter their magic. Their energies clash violently. Times Square is engulfed in magical storm. Arcane fights as hard as he can, but it's futile effort. Her power completely overwhelms him.
You cannot die, Arcane, but there are fates worse than death.
Zatanna raises her hands and causes a breach in time and space that leads to another dimension, which is an endless void of chaos and energy.
This is for my mother. My father.
Arcane, bound by her power, levitates up into the air. Parts of the surrounding area is pulled with him.
My world.
She snaps her fingers and sends him screaming into the void. He screams as he is torn to pieces and reformed over and over for eternity. The breach closes. Times Square becomes silent, save for the confused and frightened mutterings of the survivors. The rotlings begin to dissolve and crumble. The vermin return to the sewers. The rot has been vanquished. Constantine breaks free of the tendrils and looks up at Zatanna / fate.
Z?
Zatanna descends slowly to the ground.
John.
She staggers as the powerful energy that has been previously coursing through her body begins to dissipate and drain her life force. She screams. She falls forward and Constantine rushes to catch her. He removes the helm, the heat from it burning his hands, and throws it aside. Holland, Etrigan, and Jason approach.
Z. There's Z.
Zatanna doesn't answer. Her face is lifeless and pale. She's dead.
Help her, bring her back!
I can't.
She's gone.
Constantine caresses Zatanna's lifeless face.
No, not now.
There's nothing you can do. Let her go, John.
There was no way. She knew this. I'm sorry. Constantine caresses Zatanna's face and looks up at the night sky.
I'm sorry too. Neron.
Time stops. Neron appears behind Constantine, grinning from ear to ear.
Well, 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 the great John Constantine.
Cut the shit. Just bring her back.
Neron nods at Etrigan, who is the only other unaffected by the stoppage of time.
What's up, buddy? You look good. You know the price, don't you?
Where do I sign?
Neron smiles.
You already did. I always knew it would end like this. That's always been your problem, John. In the end, you're just too human. See you around.
Neron gives Etrigan a friendly slap on the shoulder as he disappears into the night. Time resumes. Zatanna gasps and regains consciousness. The others are all surprised by Satana's sudden return. All except Etrigan are unaware of what had just transpired. The demon turns to Jason.
I now know the cost of love and of the ways of this world above. And I know what I have to do. Allow Nimue to remain with you.
Jason and Etrigan shake hands. They now understand each other. The demon knight jumps high and into the air and departs. Zatanna is fully conscious now.
What happened?
Save the world, Z.
Zatanna looks around, the destruction surrounding them.
Oh. That's good.
Yeah, it is.
Hugs are tight. Cut to exterior garden, Zatara's manor. Day. It's a bright summer's day and Zatara's garden is in bloom. Constantine, Zatanna, Jason, and Xanadu stand around a headstone. Angle on headstone, it reads, Boston Brand, the life and soul. Xanadu and Jason leave hand in hand. Constantine and Zatanna remain by Brand's grave. In the distance, perched on the roof of Zatara's manor, behind a chimney stack, is Etrigan Grundy's severed head hangs from his belt. Eyes still blinking. He watches Jason and Xanadu with sad eyes, which slowly narrow to reveal slight contempt. Constantine lights up a cigarette.
It's two funerals he had now. Greedy bastard.
I miss him.
I don't.
Tana smiles at his obvious lie. They stand for a moment before walking toward the door to the House of Mystery, which stands alone in the middle of the garden.
So what's next for John Constantine?
I don't know. Go back home, reconnect. I'll go back to chasing the devil, who knows? How about you?
Stana thinks about her answer.
Rebuild. There isn't a lot of us left now. When another threat comes, we need to stick together.
Constantine steps inside the house.
You might be right, love. I'll keep in touch.
Slams the door shut and it disappears. Zatanna is left alone in the garden. She smiles and turns to walk away and snaps her fingers. Cut to end credits. But fade in. Exterior ancient temple, Syria, day. The temple is carved into the side of a sheer cliff face. Three men walk up the steps toward the entrance. Interior ancient temple, continuous. The temple is thousands of years old and littered with skulls and bones, the evidence of human sacrifice. The three men stand at the entrance beneath the archway, which see them more clearly now. They are young, dressed contemporarily, their faces obscured by the hoods of their jackets. They are Jason, Jared, and Jesse.
This is the place?
Of course it is. Is it not obvious?
I expected something more, I don't know, intimidating?
Not what you see on the surface, brother. It's what's hidden beneath.
Jared steps forward and removes his hood, revealing four glowing red eyes. Jacob and Jesse follow his lead. They are the same. They are the sons of Trigon.
I think it's time for Daddy to come home.
Angolan before them, carved from the rock itself, is a giant statue of Trigon's head, cut to black.
Thank you all very much for joining. This one was ridiculously cool. Yeah, thanks for coming in for this one, and we'll catch you the next one.